reacting very clearly to that. Then the drop-off in tensions when it seemed that Iran wasn't going to do any massive retaliation. So again, massive relief. And now the suggestion that this isn't over, at least in one very specific regard. Big questions as to whether Iran will allow any kind of international investigation and whether this issue, this question, will ever be resolved.
Yeah, because what we seem to understand at the moment is that two surface-to-air missile launches were detected from Iran. But the big question, I guess, is whether it was an accident or not.
I think the most likely outcome that most people have been talking about, even from right after it happened, is that clearly Iran was in a very much an alert position. They were firing missiles into Iraq, as we said, alert for possible retaliation. And perhaps something went wrong. But we will no doubt find out about that in the longer term. But more to the point, we have US jobs data coming up, which is going to have an interesting effect on our appreciation of where the US economy is going.
Yeah, absolutely. And I mean, ahead of that, in terms of sort of the annual, because these are the numbers for December, and we know that there was some skew in October and November due to General Motors. But if you look at the annual gain that's expected to come with what's expected for December, which is the 160K, it looks like it could be the slowest annual jobs gain since 2011. So lots of questions as to how close we are to full employment, what is the wage number going to show, and what is it going to mean for the Fed? We got quite a few, speakers yesterday, actually. We heard from Jim Bullard and Richard Clarida as well. And the Fed, according to them, seems pretty happy with where they are at the moment.
And an interesting little dispute between Ben Bernanke and Larry Summers in terms of whether how far the Fed can actually do anything anyway.
Yeah, and you want to catch that interview on Wall Street Week, which of course airs from today. So that also is something to get your weekend off to a good start. In terms of getting the weekend off to a good start with markets, 3 minutes into the equity market open here, the Stock 600 on its fourth day of gains, up a quarter of a percentage point on Europe's equity benchmark across regional benchmarks. The FTSE 100 up 0.4%, the CAC 40 up 0.2%, DAX higher by 0.3%, IBEX and FTSE MIB in the green. Looks like it's back to business as usual in terms of S&P 500 hitting another record yesterday. Futures look like we could build on those gains. S&P, NASDAQ and Dow futures all up at least 0.2%. The 10-year Treasury yield pretty steady actually on a 186 handle. Interestingly, we're actually seeing yields slide in Europe. So that doesn't fit with a sort of risk-on tone broadly. The 10-year Bund yield down 1.5 basis points, negative 19. The 10-year gilt yield down 2 basis points. The yen is actually heading for its worst week since July 2018. It sits at a two-week low right now. Dollar yen unchanged at 109.57. Gold also, of course, we know it went above $1,600 an ounce on the US-Iran tension for the first time since 2013. But it's now back to pretty much where it was before the killing of General Soleimani, $1,551 an ounce, unchanged today. Oil slipping slightly, WTI down 0.3%, Brent crude down 0.2%, WTI just below $60 a barrel, Brent on a 65 handle, oil heading for its worst weekly loss since November. What's also interesting as well, if we talk about weekly moves ahead of that jobs data, you're actually looking at the Bloomberg Dollar Index heading for a weekly gain. So it certainly is a week of dollar strength, and the fate of the dollar is in play with some key technical resistance. Look at the 50-day moving average, the 200-day moving average, and the downward trend since September. That's a chart you want to look at in the markets.
Okay, let's have a look at what the stocks are to watch this morning. Bloomberg's Lisa Pham has joined us here in our London studio. So Lisa, well, let's start with Ryanair, because Ryanair had some good results out this morning and their shares have just jumped 8.5% after they raised their guidance on a strong Christmas.
That's correct. And they're also pushing up the shares of EasyJet as well, which is up 6.7%. So the thing about Ryanair is they talked about having a stronger than expected Christmas and New Year travel period. And they've also had like some good forward bookings as well. Ryanair, as you know, has been affected by all the Brexit uncertainty as well. And so that is also pushing the shares up today.
Okay, well, we've been talking about in gloomy terms about the UK high street, but JD Sports, they've seen their full year pre-tax in the upper quartile of market views.
Yeah, so they're one of the few retailers in the UK that's doing well. I mean, people just keep buying sneakers, essentially. And so they are a market darling. The analysts really, really love them. The shares more than doubled last year. They were the best performer in the FTSE 100 index. And today's forecast upgrade is still boosting the stock.
Okay, and finally, Superdry. Now, they've seen their adjusted pre-tax to between 0 to 10 million on weak trading, so they clearly are suffering in all this.
Yeah, they are. So Superdry talked about having a good Black Friday performance, but the sales period over the Christmas period wasn't so good. I mean, there was a lot of promotional activity that was happening. They've seen subdued consumer demand. As we've talked about, there has still been that Brexit uncertainty. Now, Superdry's been going through a turnaround over the past little while. They had a co-founder called Julian Dunkerton who came back to the company in April. He thinks that this turnaround is going to take 2 to 3 years. It's unsure whether or not investors are going to be waiting for like 2 to 3 years. I mean, at the moment, the shares are down 24% today.
24%, that's something, isn't it?
Yes. Yeah.
So, yes, not a great great morning for them. Thanks very much indeed. Lisa Pham there joining us with Stocks to Watch this morning.
Let's turn to our top stories then. And the Prime Ministers of Canada, the UK and Australia say the Ukrainian jet that crashed near Tehran was likely shot down by an Iranian missile, probably by accident. They've called for an international probe. Canadian Prime Minister Justin Trudeau spoke to reporters in Ottawa yesterday.
We have intelligence from multiple sources, including our allies and our own intelligence. The evidence indicates that the plane was shot down by an Iranian surface-to-air missile. This may well have been unintentional.
UK Prime Minister Boris Johnson issued a statement earlier Thursday saying there is evidence Flight 752 was shot down by an Iranian surface-to-air missile. Iran dismissed the theory as not possible.
Well, Boeing shares rose 1.5% amid growing speculation that the jet didn't crash due to a mechanical failure. But when it comes to Boeing's other worries, the company faces a $5 billion bill if pilots need to get simulator training before flying the 737 MAX. Of course, the plane involved in the Iranian air crash was not a MAX, it was a 737-800. According to Bloomberg Intelligence, that issue to do with simulator training would nearly double the $5.6 billion the manufacturer is already committed in order to cover MAX-related costs.
In more Boeing news, the airline released hundreds of pages of documents to Congress that included internal employee communications mocking the FAA and boasting about getting the regulator to approve the 737 MAX with little new training required for pilots. Employees appeared to discuss cases in which the company hid software issues and other problems with MAX flight simulators during the FAA's certification process.
And turning to central bank news, Federal Reserve officials say policy is appropriate amid solid U.S. growth, but there is a risk inflation will continue to fall short of the 2% target. Vice Chairman Richard Clarida told the Council on Foreign Relations that the policy is, quote, in a good place. The Fed left rates on hold at its final meeting of 2019 and signaled policy is on pause this year.
And today, the U.S. government issues its monthly employment report. The labor market has been having a remarkable run, and economists are forecasting a December payroll gain of 160,000. They also see unemployment holding below 4%. Bloomberg's Michael McKee has the preview.
The final jobs report for the year is forecast to show continuing growth in the labor market and solid, if not spectacular, earnings. The combination should keep consumer spending healthy as the new year begins. Still, job gains for all of 2019 are on a pace to be the slowest since 2011. And the consensus forecast is hiring will slow considerably this year, though not enough to push unemployment significantly higher. Barring a major surprise, December's jobs numbers aren't expected to have much effect on the markets or the Fed, which has signaled it's on hold for the year. In Washington, Michael McKee, Bloomberg Daybreak Europe.
And here in the UK, unthinkable just a few months ago, a Brexit bill has cleared the House of Commons. It puts an end to the parliamentary gridlock that cost Theresa May her job last year. The bill now passes to the House of Lords. Johnson wants the measures to become law before the end of the month so the UK can leave the EU on January the 31st.
Those are your top stories for the latest in global news. Here's Leanne Gerrans. Hi, Leanne.
Good morning, Naira. Let's start in Taiwan, where voters are heading to the polls on Saturday in an election that will determine the democracy's future. Bloomberg's Samson Ellis says it faces pressure to pick sides in the global power struggle between the US and China.
President Tsai Ing-wen of the ruling Democratic Progressive Party is seeking a second term in the face of competition from Han Kuo-yu of the main opposition Kuomintang. Analysts widely expect a win for Tsai, who has attracted large crowds to her rallies in recent months after forcefully backing Hong Kong protests against China's increasing grip over the city. In Taipei, Samson Ellis, Bloomberg Daybreak Europe.
Staying in Asia, more people in Hong Kong are showing signs of post-traumatic stress disorder than ever before. Bloomberg's Brian Curtis reports.
This data come after months of protests here. A decade-long study published today in The Lancet. The prevalence of probable depression in local residents has doubled since the Occupy Central movement in 2014. The University of Hong Kong interviewed more than 18,000 people for the study. About 20% of them report depression or PTSD. In Hong Kong, Brian Curtis, Bloomberg Daybreak Europe.
In Australia, dozens of communities in the southeast are again in danger from wildfires. At least 26 people have been killed and more than 200,000 homes destroyed in the past few months. Bloomberg's Jason Scott has the latest.
The scale and ferocity of the fires has shocked Australians and the world. Blazes are so large they've generated their own thunderstorms, causing lightning strikes that sparked more wildfires in forests rendered tender dry by an ongoing drought. Extreme weather on Friday may cause at least two major fires to merge, creating a mega inferno on the New South Wales and Victoria state borders. In Canberra, Jason Scott, Bloomberg Daybreak Europe.
Unwanted restaurant manager, competitive salary, $100,000. But the job isn't at some haute cuisine outfit with a stack of Michelin stars. No, it's not. It's actually at Taco Bell. The fast food chain is trialing the attractive pay package, hoping it will attract top-level staff and keep them on board. Global News, 24 hours a day, on air and on Quick Take by Bloomberg, powered by more than 2,700 journalists and analysts in more than 120 countries. I'm Leanne Gerrans. This is Bloomberg. Roger.
Leanne, thank you. Now with the morning sport, here's William Esler.
England captain Harry Kane will have limited time to prove his fitness ahead of Euro 2020. His club Tottenham have confirmed the striker will only return to training in April, meaning he spent 4 months on the sidelines. Kane needs surgery to repair a ruptured tendon in his left hamstring after suffering the injury in last week's Premier League defeat to Southampton. England will play all three of their group matches at Wembley, with the stadium also hosting the semi-finals and final. West Ham's move for goalkeeper Darren Randolph has been delayed as he can't pass a medical. David Moyes' side face Sheffield United in the Premier League tonight, and he's been keen to bolster his squad after backup keeper Roberto's disastrous spell, deputising for Lukas Fabianski earlier this season. Sale look to keep their slim hopes of qualifying for the knockout stages of Rugby Union's Champions Cup alive tonight. They travel to La Rochelle, and a win would move them above Glasgow in Pool 2. Elsewhere, there's a basement battle in Pool 3, as already eliminated Bath and Harlequins meet.
That's your European sports. Still ahead on Bloomberg Daybreak Europe, US intelligence increasingly believe the Ukrainian jet that crashed outside Tehran was shot down by a missile. We get the latest next.
Asset managers who seize change to launch new strategies, add distribution channels, or exploit new technology to re-engineer the investor experience are often rewarded. However, in an industry paralyzed with complexity, few act with agility or decisively. Few run their businesses strategically, yet the most competitive managers in the market know with the right partner and a flexible operating system, you can. Go boldly toward change with SEI Investment Manager Services.
I'm Steve Meyer, President of SEI's Investment Manager Services. At SEI, we understand the emerging forces that will define success for asset managers and what firms will need to compete tomorrow. That's why we continually optimize SEI's global operating platform. If your business requires greater agility, our advanced technology, integrated best-in-class systems, and multi-asset expertise can be your catalyst for business transformation.
With SEI Investment Manager Services, you lead the charge in a competitive marketplace. Learn more at seic.com/seize change.
More than just a game, baseball is big business. For the Atlanta Braves, this meant bringing a billion-dollar stadium project to life through a public-private partnership, creating the Battery, a mixed-use development that turned an underdeveloped area into a thriving community.
Always on the cutting edge of community development, Cohn Resnick advises industry participants on tax credits, affordable housing, opportunity zones, and more, helping communities reach their full potential. Explore more at CohnResnick.com/MLB. Cohn Resnick, Advisory Assurance Tax. Transform your game.
I'm a 40-year-old man that walked in there to get his high school diploma. It was very hard for me, but Ms. Araceli, she gave me direction.
At age 47, Marco finished his high school diploma.
50% of getting your high school diploma is walking through those doors. The other 50% is doing the work.
No one gets a diploma alone. If you're thinking of finishing your high school diploma, you have help. Find free adult education classes near you at finishyourdiploma.org. That's finishyourdiploma.org. Brought to you by the Dollar General Literacy Foundation and the Ad Council.
Influential conversations from Bloomberg Television. Here's Taylor Riggs.
Snap shares spiked Thursday after the social media company received two upgrades, with both firms citing an improved view towards its 2020 prospects. Cowen boosted its price target to $20 from $16. The move comes on the heels of Jefferies lifting its rating to a buy from a hold in a note published after the market closed on January 8th. Jefferies analyst Brent Thill raised his own target to $21 from $17. And Brent joins us now. Really, analysts have struggled to sort of stay ahead and head of the big rally in Snap shares. Your take on the path from 17 to 21?
Yeah, I mean, look, last year was a huge move. I mean, the stock was one of the best performing names, and I think the stock was oversold, and they fundamentally put the company back on track with the rebuild of the Android version. They've got the financials under control. There were a lot of things they got set up. We don't get them all right, and I think our view going forward is that, does it still have more room? And the answer is yes. Clearly, getting to the low 20s isn't as big as a move as it had from, you know, single digit stock ending the following year to what happened last year. So our view is that it's still a good story that's showing improvement in monetization.
Hear more interviews like this one on Bloomberg Television, streaming live on Bloomberg.com and on the Bloomberg mobile app, or check your local cable listings.
Markets, headlines, and breaking news 24 hours a day at Bloomberg.com, the Bloomberg Business app, and on QuickTake by Bloomberg. This is a Bloomberg Business Flash.
From Bloomberg's European headquarters in London, I'm Roger Hearing. Time for a Bloomberg Radio Business Flash. Now over to the First Word breaking news desk in Berlin for today's morning call. Here's Richard Jones. Richard, good morning.
Good morning, Roger. Asian equities consolidated today after a volatile week, with most indices edging a bit higher after strong gains yesterday. The Nikkei 225 closed higher by 0.5%. The Kospi was up by 0.9%. The Hang Seng up 0.2%, with the Shanghai Composite down by 0.2%. The E-mini S&P and E-mini NASDAQ futures are both trading higher, up 0.2% and 0.3%, respectively. European equities are edging modestly higher across the board at the open, with the Euro Stoxx 50, the DAX, the CAC 40, and FTSE 100 all trading 0.1% to 0.3% higher. Turning to the bond markets, the U.S. 10-year yield is 1 basis point lower at 1.85%. with the 10-year German Bund yield 2 basis points lower at -0.2%. In the FX space, the Bloomberg Dollar Index is little changed, with most G10 currency pairs trading in tight ranges. The Aussie dollar is the standout so far today, up 0.25% against the greenback after stronger-than-expected retail sales print. Looking at the European event risk calendar today, there are industrial production data from Italy and Sweden to look ahead to after France and Spanish industrial and manufacturing production were all stronger than expected on a year-on-year basis. In terms of central banks, we get the Bank of England's Tenreiro speaking this morning, following dovish comments from Mark Carney yesterday. That's it for me. For more macro breaking news, it's SQUA Go on the Bloomberg Terminal. Roger?
Thanks, Richard. That was Richard Jones with a Bloomberg Business Flash. Now, let's go on to our top story again. And the Canadian Prime Minister Justin Trudeau says the Ukrainian jet that crashed near Tehran was likely shot down by an Iranian missile.
He told reporters yesterday that it may or may not have been an accident, but the head of Iran's aviation authority called the theory, quote, not possible. For more on this story, we're joined by Bloomberg's executive editor for international government, Roz Matteson. Roz, great to have you with us. A lot has been said by global leaders. Just catch us up in terms of what all the different leaders are saying that their intelligence shows.
Well, that's right. So we have the prime ministers of Canada, the UK and Australia all saying the evidence suggests that the plane was shot down by Iran shortly after it took off early on Wednesday. And Canada's now agreed to help Iran investigate the crash. France has also been invited. But they're being very careful about the specifics of their intel. And Ukraine, for one, is still saying it's unclear if it was a technical fault or a missile strike. And of course, Iran is saying it's sure it was not hit by a missile. Perhaps really the focus is around a potentially inadvertent activation of Iran's anti-missile defense systems, because of course this came just hours after the Iranian missile strike on the U.S. Iraqi bases in Iraq. The key is really whether the U.S. president decides that this is a political issue for the U.S. So far he's just saying that he has suspicions about it, but it was also, as you said, flying in a pretty rough neighborhood and someone could have made a mistake.
And I suppose the interesting thing in this, Roz, is that the way they find out about these things is the satellites that can see launches, see switching on of radar and things. So there seems to be a consensus, certainly among Western intelligence agencies, that this was some form of missile firing or cell or defense system being set off.
Well, that's right. What we know from our sources is that a U.S. spy satellite detected two missile launches from an Iranian battery just minutes after the plane took off. And then shortly after that, of course, it was an explosion. That really now depends on how much the U.S. decides that that's an issue for it, of course, because the U.S. involvement in an investigation is doubtful at this point. It's slightly tricky for the U.S., of course, given the broader politics at the moment with Iran, for it to jump in alongside these other countries, perhaps the French, the Russians, and Canada. And there could also be the sense of any perceived risk to U.S. personnel coming in, especially being on the ground, helping inspect the wreckage. So it's unclear at this point how much U.S. involvement we're going to see, even if it was the U.S. spy satellite that actually detected the missile launches.
Yeah, and there also, like, there could be unusual complications in investigating the crash, Roz. Just build on what you were saying and tell us more about that.
Well, that's right. For one thing, there's questions about how much the U.S. will be inclined to let their people be involved, particularly on the ground. What we need at the moment is the on-site inspections, because these missiles leave a distinctive trail of evidence after they hit an aircraft. You get pock marks for the fuselage, and also they need to inspect the flight recorder. Iran is saying perhaps they might ask Russia, Ukraine, France and Canada to help decode the black box, but not the U.S. So there are particular complications here, given the broader geopolitics at the moment between US and Iran, the inclination to use this in a political sense or not. That's also a key factor. And also just the physical location. Are the Iranians going to be willing to continue to share information? And what information are they going to be willing to share for how long? That's also a key question, just how much access people are really going to get in the end, especially to the site.
So very briefly, Roz, essentially this is going to be an issue of the difficulties of getting any sort of firm answer on what exactly happened anytime.
That's right. I mean, if they can look at the wreckage, they can probably make a very initial calculation within days that there would be telltale signals that something went wrong and why. But in terms of formal calculations, that could take months, or as we've seen in other investigations that are complicated by politics and geopolitics, it could take years to get a clear answer. We may actually never really know for sure what happened, despite the evidence that we're seeing from Western nations on this. Part of that will be the Ukrainians, as you can see. President Zelensky was out this morning saying, well, it's not confirmed exactly what happened, yeah. And he doesn't know. And that's also the inclination of the Ukrainians to push this could also be a key factor.
Bloomberg Executive Editor for International Government, Roz Matteson, thank you so much. Now let's get the latest in global news with Leanne Gerrans. Leanne.
Good morning. The U.S. House has voted to limit President Trump's authority to strike Iran. The resolution says Congress should be consulted before the conflict with the Islamic Republic escalates. It is most likely a symbolic move. Democrats say it defends Congress's constitutional powers, but Republicans say it endangers national security. A draft deal looks to be in place to restore power sharing in Northern Ireland. It's been exactly 3 years since devolution collapsed, ultimately over a botched renewable energy scheme. The agreement has won the backing of the DUP, and if Sinn Féin actually approves it, the assembly could be up and running later. And finally, scientists are linking erratic weevil behavior in Indonesia's oil palm plantations to climate change. The tiny beetle used to pollinate the trees have become lethargic and are polluting less. Red-striped weevils have also begun attacking oil palms in Indonesia, which is already struggling with weaker production caused by drier weather. Global News 24 hours a day on air and on Quick Take by Bloomberg, powered by more than 2,700 journalists and analysts in more than 120 countries. I'm Leanne Gerrans. This is Bloomberg Neira.
Leanne, thank you so much. Straight ahead on Bloomberg Daybreak Europe, we'll talk about Boeing as shares rose yesterday. This is Bloomberg.
This is a Bloomberg Money Minute. Investors get the government's December jobs report this morning, which will complete the labor market picture for 2019. Economists are forecasting 160,000 jobs were added last month, with average hourly earnings rising 3.1% from a year earlier. Bankrate.com's Mark Hamrick says workers on the lower end of the pay scale will see the biggest gains.
As we get into the months ahead, lower paid workers will be the beneficiaries of a number of moves to raise minimum wages in states and localities.
Equinox, the company that runs luxury gyms and is the majority owner of SoulCycle, is in advanced discussions with investors to secure new funding. An investment from the private equity firm Silver Lake and others would give the fitness chain the ability to better compete against rival Peloton. Wall Street starts the session with the main averages at record highs. Apple led the gains yesterday, up more than 1%. Larry Kofsky, Bloomberg Radio.
In-depth analysis, concise reporting, need to know global business news. Around the world and across the markets, Bloomberg connects the dots for decision makers. Stay on top of today's headlines. Follow big breakthroughs in tech. Understand the latest political issues. See how the world's wealthiest are spending their money. Track what's happening in the markets and much more. Subscribe today to Bloomberg, the global standard for business reporting. Get it all at Bloomberg.com/subscriptions.
Inovalon is a leading provider of cloud-based platforms empowering data-driven healthcare. Leveraging deep connectivity, the data of billions of medical events, and advanced analytics, Inovalon empowers the achievement of improved clinical outcomes and financial performance for thousands of health insurance companies, hospitals, doctors, pharmacies, and pharmaceutical companies, and the millions of patients they serve every day. Inovalon. Data has a story to tell. We give it a voice. Learn more at Inovalon.com.
Business. Martin here loves being his own boss, but staying on top of all the tax rules used to drive him up the stud wall. This 31st of January self-assessment deadline, however, Martin won't be hitting the roof. Just a few buttons. He's using QuickBooks Self-Employed to make sure his tax bill is all above board. It tracks income and expenses, so he always knows what he owes. You could say he smashed it.
Visit quickbooks.co.uk for details. Intuit QuickBooks.
Do you go on the same holiday every year? To the same country, in the same hotel, with the same sea view, visit the same ancient monuments, lay by the same dolphin-shaped pool, meet the same Barrys and Sandras, and wear the same Hawaiian shirt that you'd never wear at home? Then maybe it's time to switch it up. Starting with the all-new Vauxhall Corsa, with its bold styling and up to 70 miles per gallon. To switch it up, visit your local Vauxhall dealership or search New Corsa. Official WLTP test figures for comparison purposes only. Real world figures may vary.
Start hearing more of what you want.
Upgrade to TuneIn Premium and get over 45 commercial-free music stations,
live commercial-free news,
and every live NFL, MLB, NBA, and NHL game.
Visit TuneIn.com/premium to upgrade.
The puck drops. 12 players face off to win. The suspense is pure torture, but you wouldn't miss this for the world. TuneIn brings you every minute of the NHL season. Listen live to hockey when it matters most on TuneIn.
The NBA is on TuneIn Premium.
Pointer by Anthony Davis. That's good!
Each week, TuneIn picks an NBA game you just can't miss. Two of the top teams in the Western Conference go head-to-head. This Sunday, the Clippers are at the Nuggets. Tip-off is at 8 p.m. Eastern.
Three ball on the way. He got it to go!
Three from the angle. Got it!
Search NBA to follow your favorite NBA team today.
Hey, NFL fan. Can't watch the game? Can't be there? No biggie. With your TuneIn Premium membership, you already have an all-access pass to every team and every game in the league. Amazing, right?
Steps up, floats it towards at the goal line, it's intercepted!
Listen live as the action unfolds or on demand when you can. Anytime, anywhere, all season long.
Right side, it is caught. It is in for the right side for the touchdown.
Search NFL today.
In case you didn't know, TuneIn lets you listen to the same radio stations you pick up on your home or car radio, except you can hear them from anywhere. If you want to find a station from somewhere else in the world, navigate to the By Location section under Browse. Keep exploring with TuneIn.
Broadcasting live to London on DAB Digital Radio. To New York, Bloomberg 1130. To Washington, D.C., Bloomberg 99.1. To Boston, Bloomberg 106.1. To San Francisco, Bloomberg 960. And around the globe, the Bloomberg Business App and BloombergRadio.com. This is Bloomberg Daybreak Europe.
8:30 a.m. in London, 9:30 if you're listening in Paris, Frankfurt, or Brussels. Good morning, everyone. I'm Neira Chahich.
Happy Friday. I'm Roger Herring. You're listening to Bloomberg Daybreak Europe.
Well, you know, the happy Friday that we started off the equity trading session with 30 minutes ago seems to have lost a little bit of steam. The Stock 600 given up its gains to trade flat now after 3 days in the green. Across regional equity benchmarks is a pretty similar picture. The FTSE 100 unchanged. The CAC 40 edging into the red. The DAX stays positive, up almost 0.2%. But the IBEX and FTSE MIB have also given up their gains to trade flat. Speaking of gains, the S&P 500 hit a record yesterday and futures pointing to perhaps more gains if to a muted degree. NASDAQ futures up 0.2%. S&P and Dow futures up at least 0.1%. So it's certainly some calm across markets, if not absolute gung-ho risk on. And the reason I say that as well is because if you look at bonds, you're actually seeing yields move lower. So the 10-year yield is down a basis point, a 185 handle. 10-year bund yield down 2 basis points, negative 19. 10-year gilt yield down 2 basis points on an 80 handle. We actually did see some weakness in the pound yesterday following what the market interpreted as some dovish comments from Mark Carney. The pound is flat after 3 days of declines now, 130.66. Elsewhere in FX, the yen very much in focus because it is actually heading for its worst week since January 2018. And at the moment, it's at a two-week low. Dollar yen trading flat, though, at 109 spot 57. The dollar itself, the Bloomberg Dollar Index, heading for a weekly gain ahead of jobs data. Of course, that's going to be key later on today. And then taking a look across commodities, oil heading for its first weekly drop since November. Right now, we're flat. WTI at 59.51. Brent at 65.40, both trading unchanged, and gold pretty much back to where it was before the killing of General Soleimani, $1,552 an ounce, Roger.
Okay, well, let's have a look at some of today's top stories. The UK, US government is issuing its monthly employment report today. The labour market's been having a remarkable run, and economists are forecasting a December payroll gain of 160,000. They also see unemployment holding below 4%. Bloomberg's Vinnie Del Giudice reports.
Unemployment is at a half-century low, 3.5%, and there are more vacancies than unemployed workers. Good news, but as always, challenges remain. Job growth has been moderating. 2019's gain could hit a respectable 2.1 million, though that would be the lowest in almost a decade. And there's long-term unemployment. The share of Americans out of work for six or more months is higher than any other economic expansion in data back to the 1940s. Vinnie Del Giudice, Bloomberg Daybreak Europe.
And let's get back to the developing situation in Iran. The prime ministers of Canada, the UK and Australia say the Ukrainian jet that crashed near Tehran was likely shot down by an Iranian missile, probably by accident. They've called for an international probe. Foreign Secretary Dominic Raab spoke to reporters in Montreal Thursday.
We agree with the Canadian assessment that indicates that Ukrainian International Airlines flight was shot down by an Iranian surface-to-air missile. It may well have been unintentional. We urgently now need an independent, full and transparent investigation.
Downing Street has confirmed four British nationals were among the 176 people who died on Wednesday morning, one more than previously thought. Iran dismissed the theory as not possible.
Well, Boeing shares rose 1.5% amid the growing speculation that the jet didn't crash due to mechanical failure. But when it comes to Boeing's other woes, the company faces a $5 billion bill if pilots need to get simulator training before flying the 737 MAX. Now, according to Bloomberg Intelligence, that would nearly double the $5.6 billion the manufacturer already committed to cover MAX-related costs.
Also in Boeing news, Boeing's released a batch of internal messages that won't inspire confidence in the grounded 737 MAX. Company employees discuss their deep unease with the plane and the flight simulators used to train pilots. In 2016, one Boeing pilot wrote to a colleague, quote, "This airplane is designed by clowns who in turn are supervised by monkeys."
Well, to discuss all those Boeing stories, and there are many of them, let's bring in Bloomberg Transport reporter Siddharth Philip. So Siddharth, welcome to the program. Now, what made Boeing shares surge in the first instance? I mean, there's an obvious reason, but just tell me.
Sure. So essentially, the fact that Western powers have come out and said that the plane in Iran may have been downed by Iranian missiles has sort of made investors feel that it may not be a mechanical reason for the plane going down, and that sort of give more confidence about the fact that this may not be related to something with the previous wars that Boeing's had with the 737.
Yeah, it wasn't a big move that we saw in any case, because as you sort of hint at there, Siddharth, there are a lot of other issues that Boeing is grappling with at the moment, not least the MAX saga. So update us on the latest with that.
Absolutely. So the MAX saga continues on, and essentially Boeing yesterday released a bunch of internal messages that it's essentially the pilots and other officials in Boeing had sort of sent to each other, which were pretty damning in terms of the content. And essentially, Boeing's been sort of, that will have a major impact on the sort of public image Boeing is trying to be create after the crashes and essentially bringing the plane back to service.
So Zidar, give us a flavor of some of what these messages were, because I think they're quite interesting and
absolutely
shocking, actually, if you look at them.
Yeah, so some of these emails were about one of the officials said they performed Jedi mind tricks on convincing regulators to allow the plane to fly without similar training, and they said the plane was designed by clowns and supervised by monkeys. So there's a lot of sort of colorful language that's used in these emails, and essentially it does sort of point to a problem for Boeing, because especially at a time when they're trying to sort of change the CEO, essentially the new CEO takes over next week. And essentially, the public image of Boeing will take a hit in this.
And what's the significance of Boeing reversing the earlier opposition to simulator training?
Absolutely. So essentially, for airlines, the biggest draw was the fact that the MAX was compatible and pilots would not need any more training from the previous generation of the aircraft. So essentially, by reversing that, Boeing's going to have to take a massive hit in terms of bearing some of those costs, and also they'll have to work with the airlines to see what really the cost will be and what that impact will be on the overall airline going forward.
And the conventional wisdom, of course, is Boeing's loss, Airbus's gain. How is Airbus doing at the moment?
So Airbus, actually, it hasn't really been gaining much from this, because Airbus is sort of fully booked out for their narrow bodies until 2024. So they haven't really been able to cash in on the trend. But essentially, Airbus is also struggling with production wars of its own. They haven't been able to scale up production as fast as they'd like to. And as a result, plane deliveries are delayed. We may see Airbus numbers for the year either today or sometime next week.
Great to have you with us in the studio, Siddharth Philip, our transport reporter. Thank you so much for joining us. Now let's get to the world news with Leanne Gerrans. Hi, Leanne.
Good morning, neighbour. Taiwanese voters head to the polls on Saturday in an election that will determine the democracy's future direction. The country is facing pressure to pick sides in a global power struggle between the US and China. President Tsai Ing-wen of the ruling Democratic Progressive Party is seeking a second term, and is widely expected to win for Tsai, who has attracted large crowds to her rallies after backing Hong Kong's protests over China's increasing grip. The US has repeatedly bastard China's efforts to quell Hong Kong's unrest, but India's Prime Minister Narendra Modi is getting off easy by comparison. Bloomberg's Ian Marlowe has all those details. Apologies, we don't have that sound at the moment. European foreign ministers are gathering in Brussels to put together a joint response to the crisis in Iran. Bloomberg's Maria Tadeo has the details. Apologies, we're having a bit of a problem with the sound. We don't have that either. And now on to our last story. Unwanted, restaurant manager, competitive salary, $100,000. But the job isn't at some haute cuisine outfit with a stack of Michelin stars. It's actually at Taco Bell. The fast food chain is trialing the attractive pay package, hoping it will attract top-level staff and keep them on board. Global News 24 hours a day, on air and on Quick Take by Bloomberg, powered by more than 2,700 journalists and analysts in more than 120 countries. I'm Leanne Gerrans. This is Bloomberg. Roger.
Leanne, thanks very much for that, and apologies for our technical issues we seem to be experiencing this morning. Anyway, let's go on to the morning sport. Here's William Esler.
England captain Harry Kane will have limited time to prove his fitness ahead of Euro 2020. His club Tottenham have confirmed the striker will only return to training in April, meaning he spent 4 months on the sidelines. Kane needs surgery to repair a ruptured tendon in his left hamstring after suffering the injury in last week's Premier League defeat to Southampton. England will play all three of their group matches at Wembley, with the stadium also hosting the semi-finals and final. West Ham's move for goalkeeper Darren Randolph has been delayed as he can't pass a medical. David Moyes' side face Sheffield United in the Premier League tonight, and he's been keen to bolster his squad after backup keeper Roberto's disastrous spell, deputising for Lukas Fabianski earlier this season. Sale look to keep their slim hopes of qualifying for the knockout stages of Rugby Union's Champions Cup alive tonight. They travel to La Rochelle, and a win would move them above Glasgow in Pool 2. Elsewhere, there's a basement battle in Pool 3, was already eliminated at Bath and Harlequins meet.
That was your European sport. Now, coming up on Bloomberg Daybreak Europe, Julian Chillingworth, Chief Investment Officer at Rathbones, joins us in the studio next. This, of course, as we have been seeing a little bit of risk on at the end of the week, but looking at the Stock 600, some of the gains that we've seen at the start of trading, actually, they've all been given up now. We're trading dead flat on Europe's equity benchmark after 3 days of gains and after the S&P 500 hit a record yesterday, the yen at a two-week low and heading for its worst week since January 2018. This is Bloomberg.
You're fierce. You take care of business and don't hold back. Taking care of your health shouldn't be any different. You know when something's off. Don't ignore symptoms like fatigue, joint pain, and rashes. Listen to your body. It could be lupus. We're here to help you take control. Learn how at BeFierceTakeControl.org. Brought to you by the Lupus Foundation of America and the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention.
IBKR is the professional's gateway to the world's markets. IBKR offers commissions starting at $0 for U.S.-listed stocks and ETFs, enhanced price execution via IB Smart Routing, and access to our powerful trader workstation, web, mobile, and API trading platforms. In addition, our clients enjoy the lowest cost access to stocks, options, futures, Forex, fixed income, and more on over 125 markets in 31 countries. Learn more or open an IBKR integrated investment account at IBKR.com.
Why do hedge funds and other alternative managers rely on Pershing for a highly personalized experience? Mark Alderati, a managing director at BNY Mellon's Pershing and head of prime services, explains.
In today's fast-paced environment, where the only constants are change and volatility, you need a prime broker who's both steady and agile, focused on supporting your needs so that you can focus on growing your business and producing results. Exceptional client service and advocating for our clients is at the core of what we do. Our award-winning high-touch team is just one of the benefits of working with BNY Mellon. We help alternative investment managers create great experiences for their clients. Whether it's customized financing, securities lending solutions, platform access, or outsourced trading, BNY Mellon's Pershing is a prime broker who's committed to this business and dedicated to meeting your evolving demands.
To learn more about the unique and industry-leading solutions for hedge funds and other alternative managers, visit Pershing.com. Pershing LLC. Member FINRA, NYSE, SIPC.
Sometimes in business, you have to take risks, but trading across borders and currencies shouldn't be one of them. With Western Union Business Solutions, we can help you manage the risk of doing business internationally. Our valuable experience, expert knowledge, and extensive global network makes us the ideal trusted partner for your business. And with our customer-focused support team, you'll receive a dedicated solution and personalized service. Visit WesternUnionBusiness.com. Western Union Business Solutions, a global financial network you can trust.
Do you go on the same holiday every year? To the same country, in the same hotel, with the same sea view, visit the same ancient monuments, lay by the same dolphin-shaped pool, meet the same Barrys and Sandras, and wear the same Hawaiian shirt that you'd never wear at home? Then maybe it's time to switch it up, starting with the all-new Vauxhall Corsa, with its bold styling and up to 70 miles per gallon. To switch it up, visit your local Vauxhall dealership or search New Corsa. Official WLTP test figures for comparison purposes only. Real world figures may vary.
Cutting for the net, scores! On the goal line, Marchand scores!
Hockey fans, the 2019-20 NHL season is here.
And tucks it home!
And with this team, it's really fun to be a part of a team like that.
You can hear the action live on TuneIn Premium. From regular season action to the All-Star Game and through the Stanley Cup in June. Hear the home and away call for every game, for every team live. At home or on the go, never miss a game with the NHL on TuneIn Premium.
Upgrade today.
Hey, NFL fan, can't watch the game? Can't be there? No biggie. With your TuneIn Premium membership, you already have an all-access pass to every team and every game in the league. Amazing, right?
Steps up, floats it towards...
At the goal line, it's intercepted!
Listen live as the action unfolds or on demand when you can. Anytime, anywhere, all season long.
Right side, it is caught. It is in for the right side for the touchdown. To Keenan.
Search NFL today.
This is not a commercial. This is a reminder. With TuneIn Premium, you could be listening to more music commercial-free. Get over 45 commercial-free music stations. Visit TuneIn.com/premium to upgrade.
Down the middle of the 10, got to the 5, tumbles in, touchdown!
TuneIn has your NFL playoffs live all weekend. So when you're running to the store or stuck in traffic, TuneIn has you covered.
Puts his head down, crashes and spins, and dives. Touchdown!
Search NFL and get prepared for the action.
Touchdown!
The NBA is on TuneIn Premium.
Pointer by Anthony Davis. That's good!
Each week, TuneIn picks an NBA game you just can't miss. Two of the top teams in the Western Conference go head-to-head. This Sunday, the Clippers are at the Nuggets. Tip-off is at 8 p.m. Eastern.
Three ball on the way. He got it to go!
Three from the angle. Got it!
Search NBA to follow your favorite NBA team today.
In case you didn't know, TuneIn lets you listen to the same radio stations you pick up on your home or car radio, except you can hear them from anywhere. If you want to find a station from somewhere else in the world, navigate to the By Location section under Browse. Keep exploring with TuneIn.
You love TuneIn for live breaking news from CNN, MSNBC, Fox, CNBC, and more. But when you can't catch your favorite show as it airs, it might just be a click away as a podcast. Search your favorite news station to explore all the on-demand news shows on TuneIn.
Want to hear about the latest and greatest things to listen to on TuneIn? For reminders of the biggest live sports games, debates, and breaking news stories, follow at TuneIn on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram to stay connected with the audio that matters to you.
Breaking news 24 hours a day
at Bloomberg.com,
the Bloomberg Business app,
and on QuickTake by Bloomberg.
This is a Bloomberg Business Flash.
From Bloomberg's European headquarters in London, I'm Roger Hearing with this Bloomberg Radio Business Flash. And it's very much a flat session in the European markets, three quarters of an hour into the open. Initially, there was a bit of a boost. Currently, stock 600 barely moved at all. The CAC down 0.2%. The DAX barely moved at all. The IBEX down 0.2% as well. A certain amount of concern, I think, there perhaps about what is going on in the geopolitical sphere, but also awaiting the US jobs report, which is coming out later today. The higher figures many made travel and energy companies leading what was moving on the stock 600. Looking to the US opening, S&P E-mini futures up 0.1%, Dow the same, NASDAQ up 0.2%, so perhaps some optimism about what might be coming in that US jobs report. 10-year Treasury yields pretty flat at the moment. 1.85 is the handle. Oil has been moving a bit on the downside. WTI 59.41. That's down almost 0.3%. Brent crude 65.26. Down 0.2%. The yen is at its lowest for some considerable time at the moment. 2-week low, in fact, versus the dollar. 109.59. The pound also staying pretty low. 1.3054 on cable. Well, that's pretty much a Bloomberg Business Flash. Now, here's Leanne Garens with more on what's going on around the world.
Roger, thank you. Thousands face another dangerous weekend in Australia. High winds and soaring temperatures in the southeastern part of the country are expected to make the wildfire situation even worse. Those fires have killed at least 26 people and destroyed more than 2,000 homes. A draft deal looks to be in place to restore power sharing in Northern Ireland. It's been exactly 3 years since devolution collapsed, ultimately over a botched renewable energy scheme. The agreement has won the backing of the DUP, and if Sinn Féin actually approves it, the Assembly could be back up and running later. And finally, Shane Warne's famous baggy green cap has raised more than £500,000 for the victim of Australia's wildfires. The cricketer wore it throughout his 145 test career, with the winning bid coming in the final minute of the auction from someone in Sydney. Warne's thanked everyone who wanted to buy the item in a post on social media, saying the final price was beyond all his expectations. Global news 24 hours a day on air and on Quick Take by Bloomberg, powered by more than 2,700 journalists and analysts more than 120 countries. I'm Leanne Gerrans. This is Bloomberg. Roger.
Leanne, yes. Now, it's very interesting how a number of us key Australian figures have come up to the crease, I suppose, I want to say, in the cricketing jargon, in order to try and raise money. Clearly, this is a cause that has struck almost all Australians in every way, and they're trying to find ways of helping the process that's really very difficult.
Yes, of course, and we've seen lots of this money go to the volunteer firefighters that have been battling these unprecedented blazes for 2 months now. And And we've obviously seen Russell Crowe. He mentioned it at the latest Golden Globes. Nick Kyrgios, the famous tennis player, he's been, every time he hits an ace, he's donating 2,000 Aussie dollars to the cause. And of course, Nicole Kidman and many others. And we must remember that we've lost 1 billion animals too, which need to be rehomed. And of course, people. So this has been something close to many people's hearts.
Almost two dozen people, I think, killed so far in this. So a very grim prospect. And this weekend doesn't look to be getting any better. But anyway, let's move.
No, thousands. Yeah, exactly, yeah. Roger, facing this other dangerous weekend. Hotter than hell is how that wildfire nightmare has been described. Let's get back to our markets, though. Julian Chillingworth, Chief Investment Officer at Rathbones, with us in the London studio. Julian, great to see you. Happy New Year. We kicked off the new year with surprising developments on US and Iran. Risk assets took a bit of a hit, but we end the week actually fairly calm and with a little bit of risk on reflected in some parts of the market. Does a geopolitical risk like this give you cause to reassess anything, or does it simply confirm the sort of slightly defensive stance you had towards the end of last year?
Good morning and a happy new year to you all in the studio. I think undoubtedly left field geopolitical risks are something that investors have to cope with throughout their career, and I have seen a number of them. This one, just as a comment I would make, is I don't, as much as things have calmed down this week, I think we are going to be faced ongoing elevated political risk in the Middle East, and that's something that we're going to have to come to terms with over the whole of 2020 and probably beyond. So I think we're in probably a small window where things have calmed down. As far as yes, we have gone into this year feeling that it wasn't going to be another stellar year like 2019, but it was going to be an okay year for investors generally. And we forecast in various publications sort of single figure returns for equity markets, but probably mid to high single figure, so not disastrous.
Well, no, and I mean, I'm looking, you know, overall the fundamentals, the general position. We've got a situation where Brexit seems to be coming through, less of a political gridlock at least, though a difficult time ahead. We've got a US election year. We've also got, of course, the upcoming signing of the Phase 1 trade deal, pretty much fixed in, not actual ink on actual paper, but within the next few days, possibly that on the China-US trade deal, the Phase 1 of that. So, I mean, you would look at this and say, well, overall, the fundamentals don't look too bad at this stage.
No, and I think that we are seeing an improvement, as you mentioned, in some of the macro data. PMIs aren't all above 50 yet, but they are trending up as opposed to trending down, so that's good to see. I think what is very difficult at the moment is there's the sell-side broking community are pushing hard the argument that you want to be in value. Now, I think we are slightly hesitant to jump headlong into value stocks, particularly with our client base, which is very long term. And I think that our view is that we may have one or two surprise, disappointing announcements coming out of these industrial names in the next quarter or so before we see an improvement. And economic data generally, particularly across Europe and in certain Asian economies, isn't turning quickly. It's going to take some little while to turn.
Julian, in the words of Tom Keane, you took me right where I wanted to go. Roger will confirm I have the slide on my screen that says, don't be too quick to jump on the value trade. I was about to ask you to defend that thesis, which you've just done. I mean, essentially, you think that, you know, the more reliable economic indicators are sending only the most tentative signals of global growth. Because what a lot of people have been saying is, look, for equity markets to keep rallying in 2020, the attention's going to turn to growth away from central bank stimulus, which sort of provided a lot of the re-rating in 2019. So, if you're a little bit tentative on value at the moment, does that mean that you actually think there is scope for more stimulus from central banks in 2020? A lot of people say, no, we're on hold. Central bank-wise, nothing's going to happen.
I think that Christine Lagarde and Jay Powell will continue to do what they can, but they have both made the comment, as has Mark Carney, that they need help from the governments around the world in terms of fiscal stimulus. And I think that is something that investors will be looking for and will be expecting to see in part coming. We all know that Donald Trump would love to have a bit of fiscal stimulus running in the presidential election. Whether he can engineer that, discuss. But obviously there may be scope in Europe. There's been a small amount in Southern Europe more probably to come in France. Germany is the key here, and that's going to be harder politically to achieve. And in the UK, yes, I think we will get some fiscal stimulus.
Because in the UK, at least, there's a sort of electoral promise to be delivered, apart from anything else. And obviously, historically, good point to borrow. I mean, we've heard Mark Carney talking about the way the UK economy may go, even hinting, some people think, at the possibility that there may need to be some action in the fairly near term.
Yeah, well, he's about to leave the job, isn't he? So, I mean, he,
nice for him to do that,
he
yes.
can say all sorts of things. I suspect that the MPC will be reluctant to pull that trigger too quickly. Undoubtedly, business sentiment and consumer sentiment post the election has improved. Now, whether that will hold, I think it's too early to say. And undoubtedly, investors are going to be monitoring very carefully the data as it comes through. But our view is that we may see economic growth in the UK nudged up slightly. I think the budget is very key here, and it's much more about how that's presented and what their long-term aims for stimulating infrastructure. It's particularly in the North Country, and how the money that they may look to raise by perhaps selling more gilts in the future may be spent. And that's, I think, what investors will be monitoring very closely.
Julian, what are your preferred diversifiers in the portfolio?
Well, I have to own up the fact I've never been a big gold bug, but at the moment, I think probably we have had 5% in gold for some time for our investors. I think you want to retain that holding. Infrastructure stocks, which are discuss whether they really are diversifiers, but I think they will be very much in demand, although some of the vehicles that you access through them are not cheap, so one has to be slightly careful there. In terms of the more common diversifiers in the hedge fund industry, I think we remain slightly cautious around some of the traded funds, some of the long-short vehicles.
Mm. No interest in financials particularly?
No.
Just that I gauge that.
No. I mean, I think banks, we're very nervy around, particularly European banks and insurance companies, yes. But
with government bonds, Julian, so you were talking about fiscal a moment ago, but in terms of sort of the Fed, for example, in 2020, are you expecting them to be on hold, or do you potentially see there could be some cuts? And if so, I mean, do you see bonds being just far more stable for 2020 rather than showing the sort of big gains and returns we saw in 2019?
Yes. I mean, I think in an election year, presidential election year in the States, it's quite difficult for the Fed to be too proactive in cutting rates, quite frankly, unless the economy were to take a real downturn. And it doesn't look likely that is the case. I mean, the U.S. economy has held up well, and having had a bit of a slow down seems to be now basing out. So yeah. And I think that in all honesty, bonds will be very stable.
Julian, thank you very much. Julian Chillingworth, Chief Investment Officer at Rathbones, joining us here in our London studio. This is Bloomberg.
Why do so many fortune...
Imagine yourself in an unspoiled paradise, discovering the charms of a new city, or sampling street food with the locals. Fly from London to more than 160 destinations worldwide and make 2020 a year like never before with Qatar Airways, named world's best airline by Skytrax. Our incredible selection of special fares are available now. Book today at QatarAirways.com. Qatar Airways, going places together.
Hey, NFL fan, can't watch the game? Can't be there? No biggie. With your TuneIn Premium membership, you already have an all-access pass to every team and every game in the league. Amazing, right?
Steps up, floats it towards... At the goal line, it's intercepted!
Listen live as the action unfolds, or on demand when you can. Anytime, anywhere, all season long.
Right side, it is caught. It is in for the right side for the touchdown.
Search NFL today.
The puck drops. 12 players face off to win. The suspense is pure torture, but you wouldn't miss this for the world. TuneIn brings you every minute of the NHL season. Listen live to hockey when it matters most on TuneIn.
Capital of the world, 24 hours a day at Bloomberg.com, on the Bloomberg Business app, and on Quick Take by Bloomberg. This is Bloomberg Radio.
This is Bloomberg Daybreak Europe.
What we're now seeing for the first time is this facade of absolute unity beginning to break down in the EU.
We expect that there will be some type of slowdown recession beyond 2019.
The European banking system, although recovering, hasn't recovered, and there are areas of fragility.
We've seen this before, trade talks that lead nowhere, and then tariffs. We just swing from one to the other, and markets get caught in the middle.
Bloomberg Daybreak Europe with Anna Edwards and Matt Miller on Bloomberg Radio.
Good morning from London. I'm Anna Edwards.
And good morning from Berlin. You're listening to Daybreak Europe on London DAB Digital Radio. It's Friday.
It is Friday, Matt, and it's Jobs Day. We're waiting for the Jobs Data out of the United States. It's been a really busy week in terms of the geopolitical news flow.
It's been a long week. Has it been a long week? Yeah.
It has been a long week. There's been a lot of market moves to digest, a lot of news flow, as I say, geopolitically coming through from the Middle East, tragically, for the markets to get their heads around. Stocks in Europe, though, fairly flat. We started out positively. We check the markets every 15 minutes on Bloomberg Radio, and so let's get to those markets. We started out this session, then, in positive territory. US futures do actually still point higher, up by around an eighth of a percent on E-mini futures right now, but stocks here in Europe are fairly flat. In particular, the CAC 40 has looked a little weaker than other markets this morning, but all of these markets in Europe look to be fairly flat. After a session that made modest gains over in Asia, the MSCI Asia Pacific was up by 0.4%. Currency markets not doing all that much, waiting for the jobs report perhaps. The dollar is slightly stronger this morning, but fairly flat. We are able maybe to take a step away from the latest geopolitical news flow, not maybe front of investors' minds this morning as they look ahead to getting another reading on the US economy. Jobs data due out of the US a little bit later on. Just check a couple of other assets for you. The yield on the US 10-year, 1.85%. And the price of Brent, $65 a barrel. It seems Brent and some of those other assets that we saw bid higher at the height of the geopolitical tension earlier on this week, actually falling now to levels we've not seen since the middle of December then, Matt.
It's amazing. You know, during a one-week period in which you have an Iran-backed Iraqi militia attack the U.S. embassy, the U.S. assassinate the highest-ranking Iranian general, Iran retaliating by bombing U.S. bases in Iraq, a Ukrainian plane, possibly a passenger airline, possibly shot down, during that week, oil prices finish lower, as does gold. How insane is that?
Yeah, I mean, some of those things you pointed out, they were the end of last week, weren't they? But that was all the new year period.
Well,
there wasn't a lot
Friday,
of volume in markets. Friday of last week.
Well, even if you take it back to Thursday, oil prices are lower than they...
Yes, yes.
I mean, they rallied 3.5% on Friday, but I just think it's amazing that these markets want to rally and seem really intent on being... sanguine. Can you put it that way? Can I put it that way?
Maybe you can. Let's talk about what's going to be driving these markets as we look ahead to the session ahead, the weeks ahead. U.S. payrolls number for December will provide a clearer picture, perhaps, of the underlying hiring trend in the United States. The numbers for October and November were whipsawed by strike action taking place at GM. The forecast today is that we get the addition of 160,000 jobs in the U.S., but Bloomberg Economics says its 2020 vision for the unemployment report is, quote, hazy. Let's see if there's any hazy thinking for John Raith this morning, head of UK and European rate strategy at UBS. Good morning to you, John. Let's start with the latest on the US, but of course we can't ignore the geopolitics after the week that was. On the US economy then, do you see the economy in a good place? Do you see the continuation of this job-creating machine?
We see it in a reasonably good place. I think it's all relative. We're not as optimistic as arguably the consensus is, certainly if you look at what's priced into markets and general forecasts for the economy and so on. We think, the economy does okay this year, certainly, and stays above water, keeps moving forward. We're not looking for a recession, but we do think growth is set to slow in the first half of the year in the US. And although the headline numbers and some of these background stories around geopolitics and trade tariffs and so on are giving some cause for optimism, we think there's some warning signs in the underlying numbers which are going to increasingly come into the headline numbers and slow the economy in the coming months.
You say you think growth will slow in the first half of the year. Will it then rebound to finish stronger, or are you just saying that it's difficult to look out that far?
Well, I suppose by definition, it's more difficult the further we look out. But no, we're expecting it to be temporary rather than a sort of protracted slowdown. And that's because the two factors that are driving it in the US, one is the tariffs, which for all the recent improvement around the phase one deal are biting and are showing increasing signs of biting. And secondly, or the second reason that we think the slowdown, if it comes, will be temporary, is we do think the Fed will respond fairly swiftly and aggressively with easier monetary policy. And as a combination of that easier monetary policy and the tariff impact then effectively waning, assuming things continue to gradually improve between the US and China, we do see a reacceleration in the second half. So this is a temporary slip rather than something more serious.
Okay, and what level of, if this is a temporary slip rather than something more serious, what level of response do we start to price in from the Fed? Because the market seems to be going along with this idea that rates are appropriate and the US economy is in a good place. These are the words that the Fed likes to use.
Yeah, and I think, you know, to be fair, most certainly the headline data so far would support that. I don't think there's any clamour for them to act now or any sort of suggestion that they're sort of falling behind the curve or anything like that. However, for example, we think the unemployment rate is going to gradually rise, not in the data coming out today, but over the next few months from 3.5% back to 4% and slightly above. If we start to see that, then both the markets and the Fed are going to have to start taking a different view, and that's where we think we're headed.
What do you think about the tensions in the Middle East, the possibility that they... I mean, I'm shocked, I still have to say, by the fall in the price of oil after this week. But if they longer term push up the price of oil, isn't that a problem for the global economy?
It depends why it's being pushed up. I think if it's a supply shock, which obviously the spike at the beginning of this week was all about, then that can be serious because it squeezes consumption. On the other hand, if it were more a story of, you know, overheating or heating up demand, then it's not necessarily a problem. So it depends whether effectively the global consumer is ready to accommodate higher oil prices if they come. I think the fact that, as you mentioned, Matt, it does seem surprising given what's been going on, that the oil price now is lower than it was a week ago, does partly tell you that in some quarters, fundamental demand across the global economy is arguably cooling modestly, and therefore, if the supply shock is over, and that is a big if, but there does seem to have been a sort of huge flare-up followed by a very quick and sudden cooling down again of that sort of temperature between the US and Iran and all of those conflicting tensions. If we're back to just looking at fundamentals, then in our view, a slightly lower oil price makes sense because, as I said, going into this year, we do think demand is cooling, particularly in the US.
Yeah, interesting that the Fed's Bullard went as far as to say that he saw a higher oil price as a net positive, net neutral, I should say, for the US. Sorry, net neutral for the US,
yeah.
which is interesting when you think about the effect that we used to think about higher oil prices having on the US consumer. Of course, the contribution of the US to global oil supply has changed a lot of that. As we look ahead to next week then, John, do we get the chance to focus on trade, and what should our expectations be for phase two? Is this going to be a long time coming?
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, it's right that there's some optimism around the phase one deal being signed, because clearly that's a better outlook than some of the more pessimistic scenarios we're looking at late last year. So, you know, that is progress in the right direction. But as we were saying before, we think, you know, that's reversing tariffs that were put on in September, and we think they're already biting. There's a clear sign that retail in the US is suffering as a result of the fact that imported goods prices went up when the tariffs came in. So, you know, if we continue to get progress, then clearly there is going to be more upside. But for us, this is going to be more a sort of leveling off of trade tensions for now. And the impact they've already had is negative. The signing of the phase one deal won't entirely reverse that momentum. And therefore, we think, you know, we'll see worse data before it stabilizes around the middle of the year.
John, good to speak to you. John Rafe, head of UK and European rate strategy at UBS, joining us here in London.
All right, let's get now to Leanne Gerrans with the rest of your global news headlines. Leanne?
Matt, good morning. A missile was a likely cause of the Ukrainian jet crashing in Iran. That's according to world leaders from the UK, Canada and Australia. They say it was likely an Iranian missile and probably by accident. They're calling for an international probe. Here in the UK, unthinkable just a few months ago, a Brexit bill has cleared the House of Commons. It puts an end to the parliamentary gridlock that cost Theresa May her job last year. Bloomberg's Alex Morales reports.
Members of Parliament voted 330 to 231 in favour of the Withdrawal Agreement Bill, which now passes to the House of Lords. They may try to amend the bill, but ultimately are unlikely to overrule the elected chamber. The smooth passage of the bill illustrates the dramatic shift in the political landscape since May first tried to get her Brexit deal through Parliament a year ago. Johnson wants the measures passed into law before the end of the month so the UK can leave the European Union on January the 31st and he can deliver on his election campaign promise to get Brexit done. In London, Alex Morales, Bloomberg Daybreak Europe.
Thousands face another dangerous weekend in Australia. High winds and soaring temperatures in the southeastern part of the country are expected to make the wildfire situation even worse. Those fires have killed at least 26 people and destroyed more than 2,000 homes. And now to Taiwan, where voters are heading to the polls on Saturday in an election that will determine the democracy's future. Bloomberg's Samson Ellis says it faces pressure to pick sides in the global power struggle between the US and China.
President Tsai Ing-wen of the ruling Democratic Progressive Party is seeking a second term in the face of competition from Han Kuo-yu of the main opposition Kuomintang. Analysts widely expect a win for Tsai, who has attracted large crowds to her rallies in recent months after forcefully backing Hong Kong protests against China's increasing grip over the city. In Taipei, Samson Ellis, Bloomberg Daybreak Europe.
Global news 24 hours a day on air and on Quick Take by Bloomberg, powered by more than 2,700 journalists and analysts in more than 120 countries. I'm Leanne Gerrans. This is Bloomberg. Anna.
Thanks very much, Leanne. Now with your morning sports news, here's William Essler.
England captain Harry Kane will have limited time to prove his fitness ahead of Euro 2020. His club Tottenham have confirmed the striker will only return to training in April, meaning he's spent 4 months on the sidelines. Kane needs surgery to repair a ruptured tendon in his left hamstring after suffering the injury in last week's Premier League defeat to Southampton. England will play all three of the group matches at Wembley, with the stadium also hosting the semi-finals and final. West Ham's move for goalkeeper Darren Randolph has been delayed as he can't pass a medical. David Moyes' side face Sheffield United in the Premier League tonight, and he's been keen to bolster his squad after backup keeper Roberto's disastrous spell, deputising for Lukas Fabianski earlier this season. Sale look to keep their slim hopes of qualifying for the knockout stages of Rugby Union's Champions Cup alive tonight. They travel to La Rochelle, and a win would move them above Glasgow in Pool 2. Elsewhere, there's a basement battle in Pool 3, was already eliminated Bath and Harlequins meet.
Let's get the US sports now with Pete Fox. Pete?
A couple of hat tricks from the night on the ice produced wins. First in Boston at TD Garden. The Bruins snap a three-game skid with a 5-4 win over the Jets. David Pastrnak scored three. Jake DeBrusk, 3 points. 2 goals and an assist. Back-to-back wins for the Rangers at the Garden. 6-3 over the Devils. Tony D'Angelo with the hat trick. In San Jose, the Sharks with their 20th win, snapping a 2-game skid as they took care of the Blue Jackets 3-1. From the night on the hardwood in the NBA, Philadelphia's Wells Fargo Arena, the Sixers, a 109-98 win over the Celtics. Boston has now dropped 3 in a row. Kemba Walker, in spite of a sprained thumb in the first half, would lead the way for the Celtics with 26. Josh Richardson, 29 in the win for the Sixers. I'm Pete Fox, that's your Bloomberg NBC World Sports Update.
Still ahead on Bloomberg Daybreak Europe, BlackRock becomes the target of public backlash despite the CEO Larry Fink's push for social purpose and low-cost investing. We'll discuss with Bloomberg Opinion's Lionel Laurent next. And you can listen back to a selection of our interviews at BloombergRadio.com or on your Bloomberg Business app. This is Bloomberg.
Asset managers who seize change to launch new strategies, add distribution channels, or exploit new technology to re-engineer the investor experience are often rewarded. However, in an industry paralyzed with complexity, few act with agility or decisively. Few run their business strategically. Yet, the most competitive managers in the market know, with the right partner and a flexible operating platform, you can. Go boldly toward change with SEI Investment Manager Services.
Determination and operational strength are both essential factors for growth in asset management.
Management. I'm Steve Meyer, President, Head of SEI's Investment Manager Services Division. We know that disruptive forces create opportunities around the world. If you see potential in change, our industry specialists will maximize SEI's integrated platform of data and risk management, global investment operations, compliance support, and investor services to position your asset management business for success. Come grow with us.
With SEI Investment Manager Services, you lead the charge in a competitive marketplace. Learn more at SEIC.com/seize change.
In today's volatile markets, investors need resilient portfolios to help handle the pressure. Through decades of expansions and recessions and changing interest rates, clients have turned to PIMCO to help them stay on course, no matter what course markets take. PIMCO, active fixed income solutions that aim to give investors an edge. All investments contain risk and may lose value. Investing in the bond market is subject to risks. Consult your investment professional prior to making an investment decision.
You took the first step and quit smoking, but even former smokers may still be at risk for lung cancer. That's why SaveByTheScan.org wants you to know about a new low-dose CT scan that can detect lung cancer early. It takes only 60 seconds and could save your life. You took the first step, now take the next. Visit SaveByTheScan.org for a simple quiz to see if you're eligible and talk to your doctor about screening. SaveByTheScan.org is brought to you by the American Lung Association's Lung Force Initiative and the Ad Council.
Influential conversations from Bloomberg Television. Here's Taylor Riggs.
Snap shares spiked Thursday after the social media company received two upgrades, with both firms citing an improved view towards its 2020 prospects. Cowen boosted its price target to $20 from $16. The move comes on the heels of Jefferies lifting its rating to a buy from a hold in a note published after the market closed on January 8th. Jefferies analyst Brent Thill raised his own target to $21 from $17. And Brent joins us now. Really, analysts have struggled to sort of stay ahead and head of the big rally in Snap shares. Your take on the path from 17 to 21?
Yeah, I mean, look, last year was a huge move. I mean, the stock was one of the best performing names, and I think the stock was oversold, and they fundamentally put the company back on track with the rebuild of the Android version. They've got the financials under control. There were a lot of things they got set up. We don't get them all right, and I think our view going forward is that, does it still have more room? And the answer is yes. Clearly, getting to the low 20s isn't as big as a move as it had from, you know, single digit stock ending the following year to what happened last year. So our view is that it's still a good story that's showing improvement in monetization.
Hear more interviews like this one on Bloomberg Television, streaming live on Bloomberg.com and on the Bloomberg mobile app, or check your local cable listings.
Markets, headlines, and breaking news 24 hours a day at Bloomberg.com, the Bloomberg Business app, and on QuickTake by Bloomberg. This is a Bloomberg Business Flash.
From Bloomberg's European headquarters here in London, I'm Caroline Hepke with this Bloomberg Radio Business Flash. So European stocks, so we've seen 4 days of gains, but we've actually pared back on the early jump that we saw at the open on the US Stock 600. We're barely higher at the moment. The S&P 500 index yesterday, of course, hit a fresh record high. 2019 for equities was one of the best decades for European stocks. That does seem to be perhaps continuing in 2020, despite the geopolitical concerns over Iran and trade. Markets also watching for the US December jobs report. Survey expectation is for 160,000 new jobs have been created, non-farm payrolls. Futures on the S&P 500 right now have been slightly higher. Yeah, they're up by 0.1%. In terms of the oil markets, also because of the fears over a US-Iran war or conflict receding a little bit, we also see the WTI price actually heading back below $60 a barrel, so $59.34, Brent crude at $65.18. In terms of the bond markets, we trade at 1.85% for US benchmark yields, German yields at negative 19 basis points, so down 1.5 basis points. Sterling and the euro right now weaken against the US dollar. Bloomberg dollar spot index is just slightly higher. And I'll also bring you one breaking red headline on the Bloomberg terminal that has crossed. Brevan Howard is shutting its $460 million Asia hedge fund run by Ernst. So that's a breaking red headline on the Bloomberg terminal. That is a Bloomberg Business Flash. Now here's Leanne Garens with more on what's going on around the world. Good morning.
Good morning, Caroline. Japan is seeking an Interpol red notice for Carol Gone. That's according to Japanese broadcaster NHK. Interpol has already issued a red notice for her husband, Carlos Gone. It's the latest move by Japan to put pressure on the former auto executive after his surprise escape. The U.S. House has voted to limit President Trump's authority to strike Iran. The resolution says Congress should be consulted before the conflict with the Islamic Republic escalates. It is most likely a symbolic move. Democrats say it defends Congress's constitutional powers, but Republicans say it endangers national security. And finally, happy birthday, Kim Jong-un. That's a message from President Trump to the North Korean leader. The president asked South Korea to deliver the message to Kim. It was his birthday on Wednesday. Global News, 24 hours a day, on air and on Quick Take by Bloomberg, powered by more than 2,700 journalists and analysts in more than 120 countries. I'm Leanne Garens. This is Bloomberg.
Bloomberg Opinion. Informed perspectives and expert data-driven commentary on breaking news.
It is 9:20 in the city. Time to check in with Bloomberg Opinion, where we're joined by opinion columnist Lionel Laurent, who's been writing about BlackRock, the interplay between low-cost investing and people power, and whether they mix or not. Lionel, for those who haven't been following the story, what's at the heart of it?
So at the heart of it is essentially a couple of recent public protests in Europe. There have been a few in the US, but in Europe most recently in Paris and London, targeting BlackRock. Now, what's new about this for anyone who's sort of used to the financial crisis bringing protests against big finance is that BlackRock is not a bank, and it has dodged all of the Goldman Sachs type associations of the crisis. What's happening now is that BlackRock is being targeted in France because it promotes retirement savings, which are perfectly normal in the US, but in France, seen as some shadowy conspiracy to help Emmanuel Macron's controversial pension reforms. And in the UK, they are seen as aiding and abetting climate change due to their huge panoply of investments in the energy sector. And I think it's a moment. I think it's a sign that BlackRock, which is trying to promote itself as a steward of corporate governance, it's itself facing exactly those same pressures. And I'm not sure it has an answer yet on how to deal with it.
How do normal people even know what BlackRock is?
Well, honestly, I don't think anyone who's, especially anyone who's protesting in France, has a clue what BlackRock is. I'm sure they even think it's a bank. But you know, that again is part of BlackRock's problem. I mean, you know, Larry Fink, the boss of BlackRock, has tried a lot to grab the microphone, be in the in front of the TV cameras, go to Davos, to tell corporations what people want and what people think, and the higher standards on ethics and corporate governance that people want. As you say, the irony is that people are looking at him and thinking, well, who are you? What do you do? Why are you so big and powerful and influential? And what have you done for me lately?
Do those who care about climate change and care about where money is managed in relation to climate change, do they think that passive investment is not what you want right now? You want active investment because you want investments that actively avoid some areas?
That is exactly right. So I think what we're seeing now, especially after 10 years of the market rising, of central banks pumping liquidity into the market, I think people have, especially people with an agenda, have realized that now, you know, money and corporate pocketbooks are how you actually cause change. And I think that it's strange to hear BlackRock, which again tells CEOs that you can't let the market decide anymore. People are telling BlackRock now, well, you're the market. You should be doing things directly. And what's ironic again is BlackRock as a passive fund is having to say, oh, but we're the market and the market should decide. So it's a bit of a strange borderline, you know, hypocritical trap that BlackRock finds itself in.
Who's next?
I don't know anyone is next. The biggest passive fund giants, which include
Vanguard,
exactly. There's about three of them, right? But BlackRock is pretty much number one, and it's incredibly influential in government. It owns stakes in pretty much every company out there. You know, BlackRock has actually had an incredible decade in terms of avoiding regulation, avoiding oversight, and trying to push back the criticisms which up until now have come mainly from academics, from other investors like Carl Icahn, but not the street, not
just
people.
Just very briefly, what's his voting record like? Because it has a lot of, it could exercise a lot of voice.
Yes, well, the problem is that BlackRock has been criticized by people for its voting record for academics. But BlackRock's point is that if you own every company out there, it's hard for you to really try and, you know, favor one sector over another. But more transparency on its voting record, I think, is going to be an obvious follow-on from what's happening now.
Thanks very much, Lionel. Good to get your thoughts this morning. Interesting story. Bloomberg Opinion columnist Lionel Laurent. You can read more on this and other stories from Bloomberg Opinion at bloomberg.com/opinion, or go to the terminal, the Bloomberg terminal, and type in OPIN Go. Still ahead on Bloomberg Daybreak Europe, U.S. intelligence increasingly believes the Ukrainian jet that crashed outside Tehran was shot down by a missile. We'll get the latest on this developing story. This is Bloomberg.
With a Bloomberg Business of Sports report, I'm Michael Barr. Is the Rooney Rule working in the National Football League? When it began in 2003, it required teams to interview at least one non-white candidate for each open head coaching position. The idea even caught on in the business world. But today, the number of non-white coaches in the league has fallen to 4, from 8 as recently as the 2018 season. With 5 NFL teams hiring head coaches, the New York Giants, Dallas Cowboys, and Carolina Panthers all hired white coaches. The Washington Redskins hired Ron Rivera, who is Hispanic. He had been with the Panthers. Only the Cleveland Browns now have an open spot. Many big companies like Amazon and Facebook have adopted their own versions of the Rooney Rule in efforts to diversify. And that is a Bloomberg Business of Sports report. I'm Michael Barr, brought to you by Grainger, America's trusted source for industrial and safety supplies. Visit Grainger.com.
In-depth analysis, concise reporting, need-to-know global business news. Around the world and across the markets, Bloomberg connects the dots for decision-makers. Stay on top of today's headlines. Follow big breakthroughs in tech. Understand the latest political issues. See how the world's wealthiest are spending their money. Track what's happening in the markets, and much more. Subscribe today to Bloomberg, the global standard for business reporting. Get it all at Bloomberg.com/subscriptions.
Are you one of those people who thinks it's okay to drive stoned? I mean, what's the worst that can happen? You end up driving below the speed limit? It's no big deal, right? Wrong. The truth is, your reaction times slow way down when you're high. You not only put yourself in danger, but everyone around you. Talk about a buzzkill. Stop kidding yourself. It's not okay to drive high. If you've been using marijuana in any form, do not get behind the wheel. If you feel different, you drive different. Drive high, get a DUI. Paid for by NHTSA.
Welcome to Nuffield Health Battersea, a gym built around you. You get regular health MOTs to create a plan that works for you, with physios and personal trainers on site. You'll find a wide range of equipment and classes, and our expert team will support you to get the most out of your health, fitness, and your membership. Join today to get the rest of the month free. Search Nuffield Health. Specialists in you. 12-month commitments only. Facilities stated are in most gyms. Visit nuffieldhealth.com/terms.
On a TUI tour, our English-speaking local guides will take you off the tourist trail. They won't just help you find the perfect souvenir. They'll show you how to make it. Choose from over 70 unforgettable tours worldwide. From tranquil temples in India to sunrise safaris in South Africa, on a TUI tour, we cross the T's, dot the I's, and put you in the middle. Book now and enjoy up to £200 off per booking. Booking T's and C's and minimum spend applies. Selected holidays only. At all protected.
Want to hear about the latest and greatest things to listen to on TuneIn? For reminders of the biggest live sports games, debates, and breaking news stories, follow at TuneIn on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram to stay connected with the audio that matters to you.
The NBA is on TuneIn Premium.
Pointer by Anthony Davis. That's good!
Each week, TuneIn picks an NBA game you just can't miss. Two of the top teams in the Western Conference go head-to-head. This Sunday, the Clippers are at the Nuggets. Tip-off is at 8 p.m. Eastern.
Three ball on the way. He got it to go!
Three from the angle. Got it!
Search NBA to follow your favorite NBA team today.
Puts his head down, crashes in the
snap is good. The hold is good. The kick is on its way. It is good!
good!
Did you know all weekend long the NFL playoffs are on TuneIn?
In for the touchdown!
Search NFL to never miss a moment of the action.
Did you know your favorite radio stations are in your pocket?
Yes, the TuneIn app lets you listen to the same radio stations you pick up on your home or car radio anywhere you want. To see all the stations broadcasting in your area, find the local radio section on the home screen. Keep it local with TuneIn.
This is not a commercial. This is a reminder. With TuneIn Premium, you could be listening to more music commercial-free. Get over 45 commercial-free music stations. Visit TuneIn.com/premium to upgrade.
You might already know that TuneIn allows you to listen to all the pro sports leagues wherever you go. But did you know TuneIn is also home to the wide world of college sports?
Open three, DeAndre Hunter got it!
Hand off Carruthers, big hole right side. He leaps and he surges in, touchdown!
From live college football, basketball, and baseball games to podcasts and coaches shows fueling your love for the game and your school. And the best part is, it's all free. Search college sports to find your team or league.
Live to London on DAB Digital Radio. To New York, Bloomberg 1130. To Washington, D.C., Bloomberg 99.1. To Boston, Bloomberg 106.1. To San Francisco, Bloomberg 960. And around the globe, the Bloomberg Business App and BloombergRadio.com. This is Bloomberg Daybreak Europe.
Good morning from the German capital of Berlin. I'm Matt Miller.
And I'm Anna Edwards. You're listening to Bloomberg Daybreak Europe. And Matt, we check the markets every 15 minutes. The session started out positively, but now we're fairly flat.
Yeah, we are right now looking at a mixed picture across European indexes. The FTSE, really little changed, adding less than 3 points. And the CAC 40, very little changed, losing less than 2 points. So there's not a lot of movement today, but it's been a decent week and a decent start to the new year for a number of indexes. The DAX already up 2% so far year to date, and it's only the 10th of January. In terms of other risk assets, we see oil down $65.07, gold down $15.4941 a troy ounce. Interest rates are a little changed with the U.S. 10-year at 1.8511, and the dollar is stronger against the pound at 109. Sorry, the dollar is stronger against the yen at 109.593. In terms of the pound right now, the cable rate is unchanged at 130.65.
Now back to one of our top stories, Matt, and Canadian Prime Minister Justin Trudeau says the Ukrainian jet that crashed near Tehran was likely shot down by an Iranian missile. He told reporters yesterday that it may or may not have been an accident, but the head of Iran's aviation authority called the theory, quote, not possible. For more on this story, we're joined by Bloomberg senior reporter for international affairs, Mark Champion. Good morning to you, Mark. Well, a number of global leaders then saying that the crash was due to a missile. What is the intelligence that they're relying on? What is it that their intelligence shows?
Well, you know, it is, as you say, Canada, the UK, Australia, all saying the same thing. Their intelligence there appears to be based on US satellite data, which seems to have picked up traces of two missile launches at the time of the crash. They say there is other intelligence. They haven't said anything about that. It's notable that they're all part of the Five Eyes group, so they share intelligence with the U.S. on a kind of routine basis.
Surely this wasn't a case of a plane just flying in between a missile and the target, right? Is this because a defense system was turned on and mistook the plane for a fighter, passenger plane for a fighter jet, or why?
You know, we can only speculate on that, but what we do know is that it happened at exactly the time in the window in which Iran was firing a salvo of much longer range missiles at U.S. bases in Iraq. So it would have been a moment of very heightened readiness in Iran. They would have been, certainly would have been prepared for any immediate retaliation from the U.S., so their systems would have been on. You know, as I say, we don't know for sure. what happened, whether they were shot down. But that narrative is starting to change a little bit.
Yes. If there had been U.S. passengers on board, I mean, it's a Boeing aircraft, so there's some U.S. connection, but it's limited, I suppose. If there'd been U.S. passengers on board, and there weren't, there were a lot of Iranians and a lot of Canadians, would this be doing something more damaging to geopolitical relations between the U.S. and Iran? Or does this do anything to that sort of geopolitical side of things?
Well, to be honest, I think this has more potential impact within Iran. If at the moment, the narrative in Iran is that they had this tremendously successful strike back. The U.S. says that there were no U.S. casualties. The Iranians have been saying there were 80. This is the narrative they're trying to put across at home. There was a big slap in the face of the great Satan. So if instead that begins to change and what you have is an acknowledgement over time that actually there weren't any American casualties, and however, there were more than 80 Iranians who were killed perhaps by mistake in a missile strike by the Iranians themselves. Then on top of that, you have, more than 50 mourners who were crushed to death in Kerman at the funeral for Qasem Soleimani. It begins to change the narrative within Iran from a great success for the regime and a sort of, demonstration of national pride into something much more complicated and involves competence and all sorts of things.
All right, Mark, thanks so much for joining us. Definitely a developing story that we're going to continue to cover here on Bloomberg Radio. Mark Champion is Bloomberg's senior reporter for international affairs.
Let's get an update on global news flow now. Here's Bloomberg's Leanne Gerrans.
Good morning, Hannah. Let's start here in the UK. Unthinkable, just a few months ago, Brexit Bill has cleared the House of Commons. It puts an end to the parliamentary gridlock that cost Theresa May her job last year. The bill now passes to the House of Lords. Johnson wants the measures to become law before the end of the month, so the UK can leave the EU on January the 31st. European foreign ministers are gathering in Brussels to put together a joint response to the crisis in Iran. Bloomberg's Maria Tadeo has all the details.
For the Europeans, a priority at this stage is to de-escalate tensions in the region to make sure that everyone involved takes a step back, takes a breather, and prevents further military escalation. The other big focus point is to get Tehran back to the negotiating table around the nuclear deal. The Europeans are still convinced that is the best way to sustain, retain, and engage Iran. In Brussels, Maria Tadeo, Bloomberg Daybreak Europe.
Now to Taiwan, where voters head to the polls on Saturday in an election that will determine the democracy's future direction. The country is facing pressure to pick sides in the global power struggle between the US and China. President Tsai Ing-wen of the ruling Democratic Progressive Party is now seeking a second term. Analysts widely expect a win for Tsai, who has attracted large crowds to her rallies after backing Hong Kong's protesters over China's increasing grip. And finally, the US has repeatedly blasted China's efforts to quell Hong Kong's unrest, but India's Prime Minister Narendra Modi is getting off easy by comparison. Bloomberg's Ian Marlowe has all those details.
In December, India shut off the internet and mobile phone networks in large parts of the country, imposed curfews, and invoked a colonial-era law in an effort to ban protests. Those are harsher measures than Chinese President Xi Jinping and Hong Kong officials have taken. In India, demonstrations against policies viewed as anti-Muslim show no signs of stopping and have spread across the country, with at least 26 people killed so far. In Hong Kong, Ian Marlowe, Bloomberg Daybreak Europe.
Global news 24 hours a day on air and on Quick Take by Bloomberg, powered by more than 2,700 journalists and analysts in more than 120 countries. I'm Leanne Gerrans. This is Bloomberg. Anna.
Thanks very much for that update. Let's get to the sports news now. Here's William Essler.
England captain Harry Kane will have limited time to prove his fitness ahead of Euro 2020. His club Tottenham have confirmed the striker will only return to training in April, meaning he's spent 4 months on the sidelines. Kane needs surgery to repair a ruptured tendon in his left hamstring after suffering the injury in last week's Premier League defeat to Southampton. England will play all three of the group matches at Wembley, with the stadium also hosting the semi-finals and final. West Ham's move for goalkeeper Darren Randolph has been delayed as he can't pass a medical. David Moyes' side face Sheffield United in the Premier League tonight, and he's been keen to bolster his squad after backup keeper Roberto's disastrous spell, deputising for Lucas Fabianski earlier this season. But the Scot is hopeful a deal for the Republic of Ireland international can still be done.
Darren's a goalkeeper we've identified we'd like to bring. At the moment, he's just carrying a bit of an injury that he's had for several weeks, and we have to make sure that injury's completely healed. So that's where the bit of delay is coming at this moment in time.
Rangers midfielder Stephen Davis says he wouldn't be surprised if the Scottish Premiership title race isn't decided until the final day of the season. Leaders Celtic have a two-point advantage over their old firm rivals at the top of the table, but Stephen Gerrard's team have a game in hand. Davis tells Sky Sports News it's likely to go down to the wire.
I think it's going to be probably tit for tat. I think every point's going to be massive between now and the end of the season, and both teams have shown a really good level of consistency in the first part of the season. I don't see that possibly changing too much. I'm sure there'll be a few twists and turns, but we just have to try and concentrate on ourselves and focus on ourselves and try and start where we left off.
Sale look to keep their slim hopes of qualifying for the knockout stages of Rugby Union's Champions Cup alive tonight. They travelled to La Rochelle and a win would move them above Glasgow in Pool 2. Elsewhere, there's a basement battle in Pool 3, was already eliminated at Bath and Harlequins meet.
Let's get to US sports now with Pete Fox. Pete?
Basketball in Philadelphia at Wells Fargo. The Celtics cannot capitalize on the absence of Joel Embiid as the Sixers and Boston their third consecutive loss, 109-98. Kemba Walker, who sprained his thumb in the first half, finished the game with 26 to lead the Celtics. Josh Richardson led the Sixers with 29 from the night on the ice. The Sharks, a 3-1 win at home over the Blue Jackets to snap a two-game losing streak. The Boston Bruins snapped a three-game losing streak thanks in large part to David Pastrnak's hat trick as they edged the Jets 5-4. And at the Garden, Tony D'Angelo posted a hat trick, leading the Rangers to a 6-3 win over the Devils. I'm Pete Fox. That's your Bloomberg NBC World Sports Update.
Pete, thanks very much. Coming up on Bloomberg Daybreak Europe, we'll talk sterling and the outlook for the UK as Boris Johnson's Brexit deal finally gets Parliament's approval. Eric Neilson, Group Chief Economist at UniCredit, joins us next to talk about the latest on the UK eco picture. This is Bloomberg.
Hi, I'm your host, Smokey Colbert, filling in for Smokey, because after 75 years of...
Only you can prevent wildfires.
Turns out there's much more to say. Nearly 90% of wildfires are caused by us humans being careless, dumping our used barbecue coals willy-nilly. Guess the song was wrong. We did start the fire. That's why I respect Mother Nature and her trees, whether coniferous or new car scented. Brought to you by the U.S. Forest Service, your state forester, and the Ad Council.
Family properties and investments have been passed to the next generation, but while the business has evolved, has your accountant stayed behind? Burden Accountants and Advisors examines the latest business trends, market conditions, and industry issues to maximize your tax advantages and meet your financial goals. Let Burden use their insight to create innovative tax solutions for your family and your business. Visit BurdenLLP.com to get started. BERDONLLP.com. Burden Accountants and Advisors. We listen, we solve, we do.
Message and data rates may apply. TNC and privacy terms can be found at babbel.com/terms. Please don't text and drive.
Have you wanted to speak a new language, but you thought it'd be too hard or take too much time? Then try Babbel for free by texting EXPLORE to 64,000. In just 15 minutes a day, you'll be on your way to speaking a new language in just a few weeks. And right now, you can try Babbel for free. Babbel starts out teaching you words and phrases by matching them with pictures. You won't believe how easy the interactive program is. Soon the sentences get a little bigger, and before you know it, you're having simulated conversations voiced by native speakers. And because Babbel is crafted by language experts and uses the spaced repetition method, in just 10 to 15 minutes a day, you'll be speaking the language of your choice with real confidence. With Babbel, you can speak a language. Just text EXPLORE to 64,000 and start your first lesson in the language of your choice for free. Download the Babbel app or text EXPLORE to 64,000 and try it for free. Text EXPLORE to 63
is a magic number. 300 schemes to help bugs and bees, supporting environmental needs. 8,000 grants for local sports, and performing arts get our support. 7 millionaires every week, the nation's on a winning streak. 30 million pounds to good causes every week.
Who thought it? These are the magic numbers.
Your numbers make amazing happen. The National Lottery.
Rules and procedures apply. Players must be 16 or over.
When you're not listening to your team, take it to the end zone, the rim, or the net. Keep up with the biggest moments in sports by following TuneIn on social media.
Block, Cook into the end zone for the touchdown.
From reminders of the live top games to tips of the best sports stations and podcasts.
Welcome to Undisputed. We are live from Los Angeles. I'm Jenny Taft here with Skip Bayless.
Follow at TuneIn on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram to get the most out of TuneIn.
The NBA is on TuneIn Premium.
Pointer by Anthony Davis. That's good!
Each week, TuneIn picks an NBA game you just can't miss. Two of the top teams in the Western Conference go head-to-head. This Sunday, the Clippers are at the Nuggets. Tip-off is at 8 p.m. Eastern.
Three ball on the way. He got it to go!
Three from the angle. Got it!
Search NBA to follow your favorite NBA team today.
Start hearing more of what you want.
Upgrade to TuneIn Premium and get over 45 commercial-free music stations,
live commercial-free news,
and every live NFL, MLB, NBA, and NHL game.
Visit TuneIn.com/premium to upgrade.
On the goal line, Jordan scores! He takes it home!
Hockey fans, the 2019-20 NHL season is here.
Here's Petrangelo, he scores!
The action live on TuneIn Premium.
Hit a shot.
From regular season action to the All-Star Game and through the Stanley Cup in June. Hear the home and away call for every game for every team live. At home or on the go, never miss a game with the NHL on TuneIn Premium.
Upgrade today.
Hey, NFL fan. Can't watch the game? Can't be there? No biggie. With your TuneIn Premium membership, you already have an all-access pass to every team and every game in the league. Amazing, right?
Steps up, floats it towards... At the goal line, it's intercepted!
Listen live as the action unfolds, or on demand when you can. Anytime, anywhere, all season long.
Rolls right side, it is caught. It is in for the right side for the touchdown.
Search NFL today.
Are you curious what others are listening to on TuneIn? Head to the trending section under Browse to see the most popular stations and podcasts among TuneIn listeners right now. Check it out. You might just discover something new for yourself.
Next time you look up at the stars, think about this.
Inside you are the remains of a stellar explosion. You are made of stardust. And without the stars, there wouldn't be us.
I'm Guy Raz, the wonders of the universe and the people who still look up every night. Next time on the TED Radio Hour from NPR. You can subscribe to the TED Radio Hour on TuneIn.
Puts his head down, crashes in
the snap is good. The hold is good. The kick is on its way. It is good!
Did you know all weekend long the NFL playoffs are on TuneIn?
In for the touchdown!
Search NFL to never miss a moment of the action.
Markets, headlines, and breaking news 24 hours a day at Bloomberg.com, the Bloomberg Business app, and on QuickTake by Bloomberg. This is a Bloomberg Business Flash.
From Bloomberg European headquarters here in London, I'm Caroline Hepke with this Bloomberg Radio Business Flash. So European stock markets this morning heading just slightly higher, although we're paring back on some of the gains that we saw at the start of the day. So the US stock 600 up by 0.1%. The FTSE 100, though, currently in negative territory. The DAX up by 0.2%. This after the S&P 500 index climbed to a fresh record high yesterday. Looking ahead to the market open for equities, we're up 0.2% on the S&P 500. So we have a couple of big stories for the markets. US December jobs report. So the survey expectation is for 160,000 new jobs have been created. And then, of course, at the end of this week, a very tense week between the US and Iran, we see really a pullback in terms of concern about that geopolitical risk really flaring up into a direct conflict. So WTI crude oil, for example, is currently trading at $59.33, so down 0.4%, and Brent crude at $65.18. Also weaker, 0.3%. The other thing that has been interesting to note is companies fearing these Iran tensions have actually rushed to borrow worldwide. That's investment grade corporates have been issuing huge numbers of huge amounts of debt in order to try to sort of lock in low borrowing costs. Speaking of which, bond markets at the moment, we trade at 1.85% for US benchmark yields, negative 18 basis points, so down a basis point for German Bund yields. And in the FX market, Bloomberg dollar spot index slightly weaker, British pound gains a 0.1%, trading at 1.3086, and the euro at 1.1099 is slightly weaker. That is a Bloomberg Business Flash. Now here's Leanne Gerrans with more on what's going on around the world. Good morning.
Good morning, Caroline. Japan is seeking an Interpol red notice for Carol Gone. That's according to Japanese broadcaster NHK. Interpol has already issued a red notice for her husband, Carlos Gone. It's the latest move by Japan to put pressure on the former auto executive after his surprise escape. The Duchess of Sussex has returned to Canada, according to the BBC. This amid ongoing discussions over the future of her role and the Duke of Sussex's role in the royal family. Meghan Markle lived in Canada for 6 years while filming the TV series Suits, and the couple have said they will split their time between the UK and North America. It comes as the Queen, the Prince of Wales and the Duke of Cambridge asked staff to find a workable solution after the couple announced they will step back as senior royals. And finally, Shane Warne's famous baggy green cap has raised more than £500,000 for the victims of the Australia wildfires. The legendary cricketer wore it throughout his 145 test career, with a winning bid coming in the final minute of an auction from someone in Sydney. Warne's thanked everyone who wanted to buy the item in a post on social media, saying the final price was way beyond his expectations. Global News, 24 hours a day, on air and on Quick Take by Bloomberg, powered by more than 2,700 journalists and analysts in more than 120 countries. I'm Leah Gerrans. This is Bloomberg Matt.
Leanne, thanks very much for that. Now let's get over to Washington, D.C. and check in with Nathan Hager, who's preparing for Bloomberg Daybreak. Nathan, what have you got coming up?
Well, good morning, Matt. We've got the latest on the Ukrainian Boeing jet crash in Iran. A lot of developments there and new indications a surface-to-air missile may have brought down that 737, that a mechanical issue might not have been involved at all. And that's lifting some of the pressure on Boeing stock. But new disclosures about the grounded 737 MAX. Some damaging internal documents suggest the plane maker's issues haven't entirely gone away. And, of course, it is Jobs Day in the U.S. We get the final read on employment for 2019 in just about 3.5 hours now. We'll ask Jonathan Golub of Credit Suisse whether a resilient labor market could add to the risk on we're seeing in markets somewhat now that geopolitical concerns, at least at the moment, are on a bit of a back burner. So join me and Karen Moscow for all that coming up on this Friday edition of Bloomberg Daybreak. Matt?
Always great to hear from Jonathan Golub. Thanks very much. Nathan and Karen coming up next on Bloomberg Daybreak. If you're tuned in on Sirius XM, if you're listening on London DAB Digital Radio, you'll hear Bloomberg Surveillance.
Now, Matt, let's pick up on the latest in UK politics and what that means for the economy. The UK Prime Minister Boris Johnson's Brexit legislation has cleared its final hurdle in the House of Commons. This is Mark Carney opened the door to more stimulus in a speech a little earlier this week. Sterling weakened as the Bank of England governor said the central bank has the equivalent of 250 basis points of policy space. Let's talk more about what's going on in the UK. Eric Nielsen joins us, Group Chief Economist at UniCredit. Eric, good to see you as always. So Johnson's withdrawal agreement bill, the WAB, heads to the House of Lords. What do you think the UK economy does in the first half of this year and then in the second half? Because things could look a little different politically.
Yeah, that's right. I mean, I think the first thing to the first thing to remember is that the UK economy is very integrated with Europe, and therefore we have the same picture now as with a little bit of stabilization as around the world after the weak 2019. And then slowly, we think that the world will slow in the second half of next year, and the UK will also. The pain of Brexit will come later on. We have seen the first part of it with the weaker pound after the referendum and all the rest of it. But the cost of disintegrating from Europe is a longer-term pain, if you will.
Are you at all concerned about the effects of that on the EU? You know, Europe is also juggling its own or dealing with its own economic problems. It doesn't look like you're going to get stimulus. There's a question of whether, fiscal stimulus from Berlin would even do a lot for the rest of the European economy. And we don't seem to be getting inflation back anytime soon, no matter what the ECB does. Is this a really bad time for the EU to lose a trading partner like the UK?
Yeah, it's always a bad time. I mean, the UK economy is a big economy, and it's an important one, and it will hurt. There's absolutely, in my opinion, there's no doubt about it. But we have to keep the proportions right. It will not be more painful for the continent than it is for the UK by definition, right? In a very mathematical and stylized way, you could think about it according to our models, that is maybe 15% of what you get. So if you over some period of time lose 1% of GDP in the UK, it's 15 basis points for the Eurozone. But that's very theoretical. But it's that order of magnitude. It's not one-to-one.
Let me ask you about where the ECB heads next, Eric, because we had a conversation with a guest a little earlier on today about whether, as we go through the year, whether the narrative, the question might start to be asked around rate hikes at the ECB, normalization of rate policy. I know that you started your career as an economist at the Danish Central Bank in Copenhagen. I wonder if you think that Scandinavian banking has any lessons at the moment in terms of reversing policy.
Yeah, I in many ways, that is for me the single most important question for 2020, in Europe at least. I mean, not geopolitically, but it's like as an economist. Because, as you said, in Scandinavia, we've seen the banking issues, we've seen the Swedes start to reverse and start to think this negative interest rate business may not be so good. So we are waiting, obviously, for the review at the ECB. My view would be that they don't do anything until that review is done, and that's going to take about a year. It has to, the inflation numbers Matt referred to and the economics have to sort of develop in a quite dramatic way for them to not wait and go through this and think through more deeply what this has all done. In positive for the real economy, big pain for the financial sector, and at one stage that has to be reversed. Or let me put it this way, you cannot have a healthy real economy without a healthy financial sector.
By the way, one of the cool things that's gone slightly under the radar this week is that central bank heads are starting to come out and tell us exactly how much quantitative easing and forward guidance is worth. I know Mark Carney said they have about 250 basis points worth of policy room, and they're only at 75 right now. You had Ben Bernanke come out and say he thinks quantitative easing and forward guidance are worth 300 basis points. And we have a new show coming up, Wall Street Week, which brings back, you know, the old Lou Rukeyser show. And we interviewed Larry Summers. He says this is just, you know, central bankers, this is their last hurrah. This is the end of this era. What do you think it's worth?
I wouldn't venture a guess per se, but it's those order of magnitudes, right? But it's very difficult to sort of quantify these things. But the ECB has done for a lot of work, and others have done, how much stimulus the various measures have done to the real economy, and so you get down to these type of numbers, and you can. But when you're down at zero on the interest rates, I don't think you can reasonably say if I go from zero to minus half, that's worth the same as doing X on the QE side, right? But I think if I understood Larry Summers correctly, it is monetary policy is de facto out of power, right? And this is the problem, right? And in the process of getting out of power, we have come to a place where I think you can say you dug yourself into a hole where the financial sector has been turned upside down. So you have de facto insurance companies, life insurance companies, pension funds, which are de facto insolvent. And banks are still struggling with having a return on equity that sort of is competitive in the market. So how can you ask banks to get more capital if you cannot pay those who are going to give the capital, right? So something has to be reversed and changed.
Yeah, maybe we'll learn a little bit more about that with the ECB doing their review about how their policy has worked and what impact that's had on the banking sector. Eric, thank you very much for joining us. Thanks. Eric Nielsen, Group Chief Economist at UniCredit. Still to come, next hour of Daybreak. Well, you'll have Daybreak from New York with Nathan Hager, from the US, more broadly, I should say, Nathan Hager and Karen Moscow. Or if you're listening on London DAB Digital Radio, you'll hear Bloomberg Surveillance with Tom Keane and Francine Lacroix. They'll continue to stay across the geopolitics between the US and Iran and pick up on the U.S. economics with the jobs data. This is Bloomberg.
Welcome to Nuffield Health Battersea, a gym built around you. You get regular health MOTs to create a plan that works for you.
with physios and personal trainers on site. You'll find a wide range of equipment and classes, and our expert team will support you to get the most out of your health, fitness, and your membership. Join today to get the rest of the month free. Search Nuffield Health. Specialists in you. 12-month commitments only. Facilities stated are in most gyms. Visit nuffieldhealth.com/terms.
Whatever job you're searching for, you can find it on LinkedIn. Banking jobs, building jobs, extra hour in bed jobs, Waterloo jobs, Canary Wharf jobs. New year, new you, new job, jobs. First jobs, flexible jobs, pay off the Christmas debt jobs, advertising jobs, accounting jobs, HR, PR, even ER jobs. Small jobs, big jobs, work from home in your PJs jobs, or even voiceover jobs, which is how I ended up recording this ad. Search millions of jobs on LinkedIn and find one meant for you.
I've always loved a kitchen experiment, especially smoothies. I've blended all sorts of mad combinations. Strawberry and charcoal, broccoli and chocolate. Not my best, that. But when I test blenders in the Witch Lab, it's not about flavour, it's about performance. Our tests use proper tough stuff, hard ice, strong veg, rough nuts. And the blenders that can hack it are the only ones we recommend for your kitchen.
Witch tests harder so you can buy smarter. Visit witch.co.uk.
From the financial capital of the world, 24 hours a day at Bloomberg.com, on the Bloomberg Business app, and on Quick Take by Bloomberg. This is Bloomberg Radio.
Live from the Bloomberg Interactive Broker Studios, this is Bloomberg Daybreak for Friday, January 10th, 2020. Coming up this hour.
Fresh intelligence suggests the plane that crashed in Iran was brought down by a missile.
Boeing gains on the news, but immediately comes under fire on additional fronts.
Up next, the focus turns to jobs as Wall Street awaits December's U.S. payrolls report.
The House votes to curb President Trump's power to strike Iran. Plus, Joe Biden picks up a big endorsement for president. I'm Michael Barr. More ahead.
I'm John Stashower in sports. Joe Judge was by all accounts impressive as the Giants introduced their new coach. Hockey at the Garden, the Rangers beat the Devils.
That's all straight ahead on Bloomberg Daybreak. On Bloomberg 1130 New York, Bloomberg 99.1 Washington, D.C., Bloomberg 1061 Boston, Bloomberg 960 San Francisco, Sirius XM 119, and around the world on BloombergRadio.com and via the Bloomberg Business app.
I'm Karen Moscow.
And I'm Nathan Hager. Bloomberg Daybreak brought to you by Commonwealth Financial Network. For the sixth straight time, J.D. Power ranks Commonwealth number one in independent advisor satisfaction among financial investment firms. Visit Commonwealth.com to learn more.
And global stocks in a bit of a holding pattern ahead of today's U.S. jobs report, 5:01 on Wall Street. And we check the markets every 15 minutes throughout the trading day on Bloomberg. S&P futures are higher, up 7 points. Dow futures up 58. NASDAQ futures up 31. The DAX in Germany is up 0.25%. And the CAC in Paris and FTSE 100, little changed. Nikkei 225 in Japan gained 0.5%. And the Hang Seng in Hong Kong up 0.3%. 10-year Treasury down 1/32nd, yield 1.85%. The yield on the 2-year, 1.58%. NYMEX crude oil is down 0.3% or 19 cents at $59.38 a barrel. COMEX gold down 0.3% or $5 to $15.49.40 an ounce. The euro 1.1096 against the dollar. The yen 109.63. And this data check brought to you by SEI, with an operating platform designed to support all major asset classes, diverse strategies, and investment vehicles. SEI is redefining wealth management. Learn more at seic.com/IMS. Nathan.
Karen, we begin with fresh details on the passenger jet that crashed in Iran on Wednesday. Intelligence suggests the plane was likely brought down by a missile from Iran. That's according to Canadian Prime Minister Justin Trudeau.
The evidence indicates that the plane was shot down by an Iranian surface-to-air missile. This may well have been unintentional.
Australia and the UK also think a missile brought down the jet. U.S. President Donald Trump says he's suspicious of the circumstances.
It was flying in a pretty rough neighborhood, and somebody could have made a mistake. Some people say it was mechanical. I personally don't think that's even a question, personally.
Iran's government denies allegations a missile brought down the plane.
But Bloomberg News has learned a U.S. spy satellite detected two missile launches from an Iranian battery just minutes after the jet took off. Here with more is Bloomberg National Security reporter Bill Ferries.
The thinking so far is that it would be a surface-to-air missile, Iranian defense mechanisms that would have been turned on in case the U.S. somehow launched a response to the Iranian attack on the airbase in Iraq. So this would have been presumably a precautionary measure by the Iranians that could have misfired.
And shares of Boeing gained late yesterday as signs emerged that the crash may not have been caused by mechanical failure. At the close, they had nearly reversed all losses since the plane went down.
Well, now Boeing's under fire on two additional fronts. The company could face a fresh multi-billion dollar charge to get its MAX jet back in the air. Plus, new documents threaten to further damage trust in the plane maker. We get details from Bloomberg's Brian Fowler.
Boeing faces a possible $5 billion bill if it turns out that pilots need to get more simulator training before flying the 737 MAX. And on top of that, the company released hundreds of internal messages which did not paint a very good picture. We saw employees expressing unease about the 737 MAX while ridiculing customers, regulators, and their own managers. One pilot said, "This airplane is designed by clowns who in turn are supervised by monkeys."
The messages were contained in documents that Boeing provided under pressure from lawmakers. The company apologized for the content, saying it's committed to full transparency with the FAA.
Turning to financial markets now, today's big event is the U.S. jobs report. Economists surveyed by Bloomberg predict the economy gained 160,000 jobs in December as the unemployment rate held steady at 3.5%. Here with more is Bloomberg economics and policy correspondent Michael McKee.
The final jobs report for the year is forecast to show continuing growth in the labor market and solid, if not spectacular, earnings. Still, job gains for all of 2019 are on a pace to be the slowest since 2011. And the consensus forecast is hiring will slow considerably this year, though not enough to push unemployment significantly higher. Barring a major surprise, December's jobs numbers aren't expected to have much effect on the markets or the Fed, which has signaled it's on hold for the year. In Washington, Michael McKee, Bloomberg Daybreak.
All right, Michael, thank you. Though the Fed does remain on hold, it's watching the U.S. labor market closely. Bloomberg's John Tucker joins us live with more. Good morning, John.
And good morning, Nathan. The central bank is keeping all policy tools on the table. That's according to St. Louis Fed President James Bullard.
Should we get into recession, the first thing that would happen is we'd lower the policy rate back down close to zero, and then we'd turn to forward guidance and quantitative easing.
On Saturday, former Fed Chairman Ben Bernanke said those tools should be enough to stave off recession despite the low level of interest rates. But former Treasury Secretary Larry Summers is pushing back against that notion.
He argued that monetary policy will be able to do it the next time. I think that's pretty unlikely, given that in recessions, we usually cut interest rates by 5 percentage points, and interest rates today are below 2%. And I just don't believe quantitative easing and that stuff is worth anything like another 3 percentage points.
Larry Summers spoke with David Weston on Bloomberg Wall Street Week. Tune in to hear the full show tonight at 6 p.m. Wall Street time and throughout the weekend on Bloomberg Radio and Television. I'm John Tucker, Bloomberg Daybreak.
All right, John, thank you. And S&P futures are higher this morning, up 7 points. Dow futures up 56. NASDAQ futures up 30. The DAX in Germany is up 0.25%. 10-year Treasury down 1/32nd, yield 1.85%. The yield on the 2-year, 1.58%. And NYMEX crude oil moving lower, down 0.3% or 18 cents at $59.38 a barrel. COMEX gold is down 0.3% or $5 at $15.49.30 an ounce. The euro, 1.1097 against the dollar. Straight ahead, we have the latest world and national news. This is Bloomberg.
All right, Karen, thank you. It's 5:07 on Wall Street. Let's bring in Michael Barr with a check of what else is going on around the world. Good Friday morning, Michael.
Good morning, Nathan. By a mostly party line vote, the Democratic-led House has called on President Trump to respect the constitutional war powers of Congress. Bloomberg's Bob Moon reports there's lingering skepticism over the killing of Iran's top general.
Connecticut's Rose DeLauro was especially incensed Trump couldn't be bothered to inform Congress.
The administration could not provide any specifics about what constituted an imminent threat.
Among three Republicans who broke ranks, Florida's Matt Gaetz said Congress cannot delegate its constitutional duty.
If the members of our armed services have the courage to go and fight and die in these wars, we ought to have the courage to vote for them or against them.
Other Republicans argued the vote endangered national security, and as the matter moves to the Senate, Vermont's Patrick Leahy says that makes his blood boil.
They said it'd be a mistake for the Senate to even have a debate about the president's war powers. Read the Constitution!
Bob Moon, Bloomberg Daybreak.
President Trump mocked Democrats for their criticism that he should have notified Congress before killing General Qassem Soleimani. During a campaign rally in Toledo, Ohio last night, President Trump referenced Senator Bernie Sanders and the House Speaker.
We have Bernie and Nancy Pelosi, we have them all. They're all trying to say, how dare you take him out that way? You should get permission from Congress. You should come in and tell us what you want to do.
House Speaker Nancy Pelosi says she will soon transmit the articles of impeachment against President Trump, signaling a potential thaw in the standoff with Senate Republicans.
We are concerned that the senators will not be able to live up to the oath that they must take to have an impartial trial.
Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell has argued that the Senate's job during an impeachment trial is to examine the evidence already compiled and presented by the House, not introduce new evidence. Los Angeles Mayor Eric Garcetti endorsed Joe Biden, giving the Democratic presidential candidate an influential supporter in the nation's largest state. Garcetti, in a statement, says, "We need Joe Biden to bring our nation and world together during these most divided and dangerous times." Global news 24 hours a day on air and on Quick Take by Bloomberg, powered by more than 2,700 journalists and analysts in more than 120 countries. I'm Michael Barr. This is Bloomberg, Nathan.
All right, Michael, thank you. It's 5:09 on Wall Street. Time now for the Bloomberg NBC Sports Update. Here's John Stashower.
Nathan, Giants fans got a look at Joe Judge yesterday, had to like what they saw and heard from the new coach.
And what that means is everybody comes to work every day, regardless of how they feel, and puts the team first, period. Whatever you have going on outside the building, you're sick, you're a little bit of pain, your discomfort, you're upset, you're mad, you put all that aside. Come in, you put the team first. We're going to ask our players at times to do things that necessarily may not be what they have in mind for themselves. But if it's best for the team, they have to be willing to go forward with it, because that's what a winning culture is.
He clearly will bring an intensity to the job not seen from a Giants coach since Tom Coughlin's departure. Time will tell how good a coach he'll be. Giants 12-42 over the last three seasons. Meanwhile, playoffs resume tomorrow. The six seeds take on the top seeds. The Vikings, off the overtime win at New Orleans, face the 49ers, their first playoff game in 6 years. The Titans, who upset the Patriots, are now in Baltimore, and the Ravens have won 12 in a row. No six seed has advanced to the conference championship since 2010, when both the Packers and Jets did it. At the Garden, Rangers beat the Devils 6-3. A couple of standout performances. Tony D'Angelo was in on 5 of the 6 goals, scored the hat trick, assisted on 2 others, and Igor Shesterkin made 46 saves, and the 24-year-old rookie is now 2-0. Garden tonight has the Knicks and Pelicans. At Barclays, it's the Nets and vastly improved Miami. Kyrie Irving was in full practice yesterday in Brooklyn. He could be returning soon from that shoulder injury that's kept him out for 2 months. The Nets have lost 7 in a row. With the Bloomberg NBC Sports Update, I'm John Stashower. Nathan?
All right, John, thanks. And please join us tonight for the Bloomberg Business of Sports Show. It is one of the biggest rivalries in the classroom and the football field. Now Harvard and Yale are facing off in a hockey game this weekend at Madison Square Garden. We speak to Leverage Agency founder Ben Sterner, whose company operates the event, selling sponsorships and tickets. You can catch that conversation tonight at 8 and tomorrow at 11 a.m. on Bloomberg Radio, or subscribe to Bloomberg Business of Sports wherever you get your podcasts. Futures pointing to a higher open this morning on Jobs Friday. S&P futures are higher by 8 points. Dow futures up 63. NASDAQ futures almost 32 points higher. You're listening to Bloomberg Daybreak.
Business is constantly evolving. Is your financial printer evolving to keep ahead of the curve? At Command Financial, we are redefining financial printing by providing industry-leading expertise, leveraging technology, and honing processes and best practices. Every day, Command helps SEC registrants
as well as members of their working groups, including securities attorneys and investment bankers, prepare, file, and disseminate regulatory and disclosure documents, such as registration statements, M&A documents, and mutual fund prospectuses and reports. Command provides a full range of services to help you effectively complete your deal, meet your disclosure requirements, and achieve your shareholder communications objectives. Visit our website at commandfinancial.com and learn how we're evolving, not only with the times, but also with your business requirements. Command Financial, redefining financial printing.
Imagine. Imagine being denied an apartment because of your religion, or your race, or because you have children, or a disability.
It's so wrong.
Yes, but who has the power to stop this?
You do. Each of us has the power. The law is on your side. It's illegal for landlords to discriminate because of race, color, religion, sex, national origin, disability, or familial status. If you suspect that you have experienced housing discrimination, file a complaint with HUD immediately so we can investigate it. Fair housing is your right.
Use it.
To learn more, visit HUD.gov/fairhousing. That's HUD.gov/fairhousing. Or call 1-800-669-9777. 1-800-669-9777. A public service message from HUD in partnership with the National Fair Housing Alliance.
This is not a cat. This is not a rocket. And this is not a sale. That's right. At Smarty Mobile, we're not having a sale. While others are slashing prices, we're introducing our best ever new plans. Take our new 30-gig data SIM for just £10 a month. With unlimited calls and texts and no speed restrictions, credit checks or contract tying you down, why shop around? New plans, great value. Now that's Smarty. Grab yours today. Search Smarty Mobile. See smarty.co.uk for terms.
Imagine yourself in an unspoiled paradise, discovering the charms of a new city, or sampling street food with the locals. Fly from London to more than 160 destinations worldwide and make 2020 a year like never before with Qatar Airways. Named world's best airline by Skytrax. Our incredible selection of special fares are available now. Book today at QatarAirways.com. Qatar Airways. Going places. Together.
Hey, NFL fan. Can't watch the game? Can't be there? No biggie. With your TuneIn Premium membership, you already have an all-access pass to every team and every game in the league. Amazing, right?
Steps up, floats it towards... At the goal line, it's intercepted!
Listen live as the action unfolds, or on demand when you can. Anytime, anywhere, all season long.
Throws right side, it is caught. It is in for the right side for the touchdown.
Search NFL today.
Upgrade to TuneIn Premium and get over 45 commercial-free music stations.
You'll also get live commercial-free news,
plus live play-by-play games from NFL, MLB, NBA, and NHL.
Score!
Visit TuneIn.com/premium to upgrade.
Down the middle of the 10, got to the 5, tumbles in, touchdown!
TuneIn has your NFL playoffs live all weekend. So when you're running to the store or stuck in traffic, TuneIn has you covered.
Puts his head down, crashes and spins, and dives. Touchdown!
Search NFL and get prepared for the action.
Touchdown!
From Bloomberg Television. Here's Taylor Riggs.
Snap shares spiked Thursday after the social media company received two upgrades, with both firms citing an improved view towards its 2020 prospects. Cowen boosted its price target to $20 from $16. The move comes on the heels of Jefferies lifting its rating to a buy from a hold in a note published after the market closed on January 8th. Jefferies analyst Brent Thill raised his own target to $21 from $17. And Brent joins us now. Really, analysts have struggled to sort of stay ahead and head of the big rally in Snap shares. Your take on the path from 17 to 21?
Yeah, I mean, look, last year was a huge move. I mean, the stock was one of the best performing names, and I think the stock was oversold, and they fundamentally put the company back on track with the rebuild of the Android version. They've got the financials under control. There were a lot of things they got set up. We don't get them all right, and I think our view going forward is that, does it still have more room? And the answer is yes. Clearly, getting to the low 20s isn't as big as a move as it had from, you know, single digit stock ending the following year to, in the past year to what happened last year. So our view is that it's still a good story that's showing improvement in monetization.
Hear more interviews like this one on Bloomberg Television, streaming live on Bloomberg.com and on the Bloomberg mobile app, or check your local cable listings. Markets, headlines, and breaking news 24 hours a day at Bloomberg.com, the Bloomberg Business app, and on Quick Take by Bloomberg. This is a Bloomberg Business Flash.
And I'm Karen Moscow. U.S. stock index futures are edging higher this morning ahead of a key jobs report. Treasuries are drifting alongside the dollar as a tumultuous week draws to a close. We check the markets every 15 minutes throughout the trading day on Bloomberg. S&P futures are up about 8 points. Dow futures up 61. NASDAQ futures up 33. The DAX in Germany is up 0.25%. 10-year Treasury, little change. Yield 1.85%. The yield on the 2-year, 1.58%. NYMEX crude oil is down a third of a percent or 20 cents at $59.36 a barrel. COMEX gold is down 0.3% or $4.50 at $15.49.80 an ounce. The euro, 1.1097 against the dollar. British pound, 1.3068. And the yen at 109.64. And the December jobs report is out at 8:30 Wall Street time. That at 10, it's wholesale inventories. And that's a Bloomberg Business Flash. Now here's Michael Barr with more on what's going on around the world. Michael, good morning.
Good morning, Karen. Iran has invited the National Transportation Safety Board to take part in the probe of this week's crash of a Ukrainian jetliner near Tehran. It comes as Canadian Prime Minister Justin Trudeau says evidence indicates the plane was shot down by an Iranian missile. More than a third of the 176 people aboard the Ukrainian International Airlines jet were from Canada. The Democratic-controlled House has approved a non-binding resolution asserting that President Trump must seek approval from Congress before engaging in further military action against Iran. President Trump claims he has no obligation to give lawmakers advance warning, saying Democrats want us to tell them so they can leak it to their friends in the corrupt media. In the NHL, the Rangers beat the Devils 6-3. The Bruins won. In the NBA, the Celtics lost. Global news 24 hours a day on air and on Quick Take by Bloomberg, powered by more than 2,700 journalists and analysts in more than 120 countries. I'm Michael Barr. This is Bloomberg, Nathan.
All right, Michael, thanks. It's 519 on Wall Street. Live from the Bloomberg Interactive Broker Studios, this is Bloomberg Daybreak. We're pleased to welcome Jonathan Golub to the program this morning, Chief U.S. Equity Strategist at Credit Suisse. What a week this has been, Jonathan. I think volatile is maybe understating it. Is this the right environment to put risk back on the table after all the geopolitical concerns we've seen this week?
I think it probably is. And if there's a lesson from what we've seen with all this Iran news, is that when you have newspaper headlines, those tend to not disrupt markets over the long run, but tend to be very temporary and are more likely to create a buying opportunity to the extent that the market gets the jitters. If you look at volatility, not as measured by the way that we see the news headlines, but by the VIX, which is like the market's measure of volatility, the market's saying that things are pretty healthy.
So where do you see volatility longer term, and how do you take advantage of it?
Well, it's actually pretty clear that while the headlines sound like there's lots of volatility, and we have, the biggest news story this year is going to be an election cycle, the market is telling you that there's not a lot of volatility, and in periods where volatility is lower, stocks go higher, and it's not stocks. In general, there are certain types of companies that do better in a period when the market's confident. And I think that that's really what we're entering right now, a period of time where investor confidence is higher.
And that, I would imagine, is underpinned by the trade environment now that we've got a phase one trade deal that's going to be put pen to paper next week. Are there still, though, lingering trade tensions between the U.S. and China that could cause concern for the market?
Well, first, I don't think that the market is really expecting, Nathan, some huge move on trade. So the escalation of tariffs and all that is probably behind us for the near term. But let's remember why all these trade issues came up. It was that China wasn't really playing by the same rules as others. And that story around intellectual property and things of that nature, access to their markets, that really hasn't been fully resolved. So there's a lot more to do, but what's happened is that the tensions have come down. But the bigger story, you know, right now driving the markets is this belief that the economy is going to improve, and the market is saying is that if we're in an environment where the economics are getting better, then don't worry so much about the news flow, that it's ultimately the economy that's really driving things. And today should be another example of that success. We have a jobs report coming out, and the expectation is that we're going to have continued healthy hiring.
So let's get into the jobs report a little bit here. What are your expectations for what we'll see in the December payrolls? And what could it mean for the Fed, which has been indicating that it's going to stay on the sidelines through this election year?
All right, so I'm cheating here, Nathan, because my expectation on where the jobs really starts with, you know, I go into the Bloomberg terminal and you see mm-hmm. something in the ballpark of 160,000 jobs that were likely created over the last month, and that the unemployment rate is likely going to stay steady at around 3.5. But what's important about 160,000 jobs is that they were only bringing in about, let's say, 90,000 new workers into the labor force each month, which means about 70,000 people who were not employed, whether they were looking or whether they were pulled out of retirement or what have you, are being put to work. And so that's really the story. And it's really quite amazing that, you know, 10 to 11 years, you know, into this business cycle, we're still adding so many more jobs than the trend of job entrance. It's extremely healthy. What the market though is looking for, which is not what's coming out today, is the industrial data, which has been a little bit less healthy. Remember, we're a service economy, and that's been healthy, but the industrial side of things has been weaker, and that has been much more choppy and mixed, both here in the U.S. as well as abroad, and that's what the market is betting on.
Thanks for this. As always, good talking with you, Jonathan. That's Jonathan Golub, Chief U.S. Equity Strategist at Credit Suisse. The December payrolls report out at 8:30 a.m. Wall Street time. As always, we will have full details and analysis for you here on Bloomberg Radio. Ahead of that, futures pointing to a slightly higher open on Wall Street. This is Bloomberg.
This is a Bloomberg Money Minute. Jobs take center stage today as the Labor Department issues its December numbers. Economists surveyed by Bloomberg are estimating job gains of around 160,000 and an unemployment rate remaining at 3.5%. Lyft has offered up to $600 apiece for New York rideshare drivers to settle a lawsuit alleging the company misclassified them as contractors instead of employees. But Bloomberg has learned that the drivers' attorneys believe the offer is too low and are telling their clients not to accept it. Boeing has released a new batch of internal messages in which company employees discussed deep unease with the 737 MAX and problems in flight simulators used to train pilots on the new jet, which was later involved in two fatal crashes. Boeing had already provided the documents to lawmakers and the FAA. Stock futures signal a higher open with Wall Street at record highs after yesterday's gains. The Dow jumped 212 points. Gina Cervetti, Bloomberg Radio.
Message and data rates may apply. TNC and privacy terms can be found at babbel.com/terms. Please don't text and drive.
Have you wanted to speak a new language, but you thought it'd be too hard or take too much time? Then try Babbel for free by texting EXPLORE to 64000. In just 15 minutes a day, you'll be on your way to speaking a new language in just a few weeks. And right now, you can try Babbel for free. Babbel starts out teaching you words and phrases by matching them with pictures. You won't believe how easy the interactive program is. Soon the sentences get a little bigger, and before you know it, you're having simulated conversations voiced by native speakers. And because Babbel is crafted by language experts and uses the spaced repetition method, in just 10 to 15 minutes a day, you'll be speaking the language of your choice with real confidence. With Babbel, you can speak a language. Just text EXPLORE to 64000 and start your first lesson in the language of your choice for free. Download the Babbel app or text EXPLORE to 64000 and try it for free. Text EXPLORE.
This year, it's time to live well your way. Time to hit boots. To reboot your get up and go. Reboot your fresh start. Reboot your vegan choices. And reboot your... Make 2020 your time for a reboot. Save up to half price on well-being products in-store, on Boots.com, or via the app. Boots. Let's feel good. Subject to availability. Exclusions apply. See in-store or online for details. Offer ends 28th of January.
You don't just live in one room, so why should you Wi-Fi? With Sky Broadband's Wi-Fi guarantee, you'll get Wi-Fi in every room or money back. Perfect for food shopping in the bedroom, gaming in your PJs in the lounge, or streaming sci-fi movies in the kitchen. Get Sky's super-fast broadband and Wi-Fi guarantee. £32 a month for 18 months with £19.95 setup. Click on the banner now.
Sky Fiber areas, Sky kit required. Refund on boost component of subscription paid during current minimum term up to date of claim. Minimum 3 megabits per second or money back. Prices may change during minimum term. See sky.com/guarantee.
The NBA is on TuneIn Premium.
Pointer by Anthony Davis. That's good!
Each week, TuneIn picks an NBA game you just can't miss. Two of the top teams in the Western Conference go head-to-head. This Sunday, the Clippers are at the Nuggets. Tip-off is at 8 p.m. Eastern.
Three ball on the way. He got it to go!
Three from the angle. Got it!
Search NBA to follow your favorite NBA team today.
Next time you look up at the stars, think about this.
Inside you are the remains of a stellar explosion. You are made of stardust. And without the stars, there wouldn't be us.
I'm Guy Raz, the wonders of the universe and the people who still look up every night. Next time on the TED Radio Hour from NPR. You can subscribe to the TED Radio Hour on TuneIn.
When you're not listening to your team, take it to the end zone, the rim, or the net. Keep up with the biggest moments in sports by following TuneIn on social media. From reminders of the live top games to tips of the best sports stations and podcasts.
Welcome to Undisputed. We are live from Los Angeles. I'm Jenny Taft here with Skip Bayless.
Follow and tune in on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram to get the most out of TuneIn.
Live from the Bloomberg Interactive Broker Studio in New York. Bloomberg 1130 to Washington, D.C. Bloomberg 991 to Boston. Bloomberg 1061 to San Francisco. Bloomberg 960 to the country. Sirius XM Channel 119 and around the globe. The Bloomberg Business App and BloombergRadio.com. This is Bloomberg Daybreak.
And it's 5:30 on Wall Street. Good morning, I'm Nathan Hager.
And I'm Karen Moscow. We're just about 4 hours away from the opening of U.S. trading. Let's get you up to date on the news you need to know at this hour, beginning with the latest details on the passenger jet that crashed in Iran Wednesday. Intelligence now suggests the plane was likely brought down by a missile from Iran, according to Canadian Prime Minister Justin Trudeau.
The evidence indicates that the plane was shot down by an Iranian surface-to-air missile. This may well have been unintentional.
And the prime ministers of Australia and the UK also think an Iranian missile brought down the jet. President Donald Trump says he's suspicious of the circumstances.
It was flying in a pretty rough neighborhood, and somebody could have made a mistake. Some people say it was mechanical. I personally don't think that's even a question, personally.
Bloomberg News has learned a U.S. spy satellite detected two missile launches from an Iranian battery just minutes after the jet took off. We get more from Bloomberg National Security reporter Bill Ferries.
On the night that this plane went down, for whatever reason, that was some of the most heavily watched airspace anywhere in the world, given the attack. It would be an enormous coincidence if, on the night of a strike like that, a plane happened to go down for a mechanical failure.
Shares of Boeing gained late yesterday as signs emerged the crash may not have been caused by mechanical failure, but now Boeing is under fire on another front. The company released a new batch of internal messages with employees discussing concern over the 737 MAX jet. One pilot said, quote, "This airplane is is designed by clowns who in turn are supervised by monkeys.
Turning to financial markets now, the big event of the day is the U.S. jobs report. Economists forecast a December payroll gain of 160,000 with unemployment holding at 3.5%. And here with more is Bloomberg's Vinny Dalgiudice.
Job growth has been moderating. 2019's gain could hit a respectable 2.1 million, though that would be the lowest in almost a decade. And there's long-term unemployment. The share of Americans out of work for six or more months is higher than any other economic expansion in data back to the 1940s. Vinny Dalgiudice, Bloomberg Daybreak.
All right, Vinny, thank you. And global stocks are in a holding pattern ahead of the jobs report, and U.S. stock index futures are moving higher, with S&P futures up 8 points, Dow futures up 67, NASDAQ futures up 34. The DAX in Germany is up 0.3%. 10-year Treasury up 1/32nd, yield 1.84%. The yield on the 2-year, 1.58%. NYMEX crude oil is down 0.4% or 22 cents at $59.34 a barrel. COMEX gold is down 0.3% or $4.60 at $15.49.80 an ounce. And the euro 1.1094 against the dollar. Straight ahead, we have the latest world and national news. And this is Bloomberg.
All right, thanks, Karen. It's 5:33 on Wall Street. Let's bring in Michael Barr once again for a check of what else is going on around the world. Michael.
Thank you very much, Nathan. The House of Representatives voted mainly along party lines to limit President Donald Trump's authority to strike Iran. Democrats say it defends Congress's constitutional powers. The debate was led by Michigan Congresswoman Alyssa Slotkin, a former CIA officer who did 3 tours in Iraq.
The United States always maintains the right and the responsibility to ensure the safety of our diplomatic personnel and our armed forces serving abroad. But when it comes to the matter of longer-term war, either as something that we choose as a nation or as something that we find ourselves in, as members of this body, we have a constitutional responsibility to authorize the use of military force.
But Republicans say it endangers national security. Tensions in the Middle East remain high after a U.S. drone strike killed Iranian General Qassem Soleimani. Iran retaliated with a missile striking an Iraqi base used by U.S. troops late Tuesday. Meanwhile, President Trump claims he has no obligation to give lawmakers advance warning, saying Democrats like House Speaker Nancy Pelosi want us to tell them so they can leak it to their friends in the corrupt media. Trump at a rally in Toledo, Ohio, defended his decision to kill Soleimani without informing Congress.
Soleimani was actively planning new attacks, and he was looking very seriously at our embassies, and not just the embassy in Baghdad, but we stopped him, and we stopped him quickly, and we stopped him cold.
House Speaker Pelosi says she will soon transmit the articles of impeachment against President Trump. It signals a potential thaw in the standoff with Senate Republicans as she warned against rushing to an acquittal without a fair trial. Federal prosecutors told a judge video footage of the area around Jeffrey Epstein's jail cell on a day he survived an apparent suicide attempt no longer exists. Officials at the Metropolitan Correctional Center in New York believe they had preserved footage of guards finding Epstein after he appeared to have attempted suicide, but actually saved a video from a different part of the jail. The FBI also has determined that the footage does not exist on the jail's backup video system as a result of technical errors. Global news 24 hours a day on air and on Quick Take by Bloomberg, powered by more than 2,700 journalists and analysts in more than 120 countries. I'm Michael Barr. This is Bloomberg, Nathan.
Thank you, Michael. 5:35 on Wall Street. Time for the Bloomberg NBC Sports Update. Here's John Stashower.
Nathan, 3 days after the surprise hiring of Joe Judge, the Giants introduced the 19th coach in franchise history. The Giants co-owner with Steve Tisch is John Mara.
I have to tell you that this was perhaps the best coach interview that I've ever been a part of. When Steve met with him on Tuesday morning, he felt just as strongly as we did. Joe is someone who has certainly been on our radar for the last couple of years. When a coach works under Nick Saban and then finds his way onto Bill Belichick's staff, that's something that you take note of.
And as Judge met the media, it was clear why he did so well in that interview.
I want this team to reflect this area. I want the people that pay their hard-earned money in the neighborhoods of New York, North Jersey, South Jersey to come to our games and note the players on the field play with the same attitude they wake up with every morning. That is blue collar. It's hard work. It's in your face. We're not going to back down from anybody.
Nowhere to go but up. Giants 12-42 last 3 years. As for the playoffs, two games tomorrow, two more Sunday. Of the eight teams left, three have never won a Super Bowl. Another, the Chiefs haven't won one over 50 years, and the 49ers in over 20. Worth noting, last year, the four home teams all won in the divisional round. For 15 years, the Rangers' number one goalie has been Henrik Lundqvist. Is that changing? Second straight game, the 37-year-old Lundqvist was on the bench. He watched 24-year-old rookie Igor Shesterkin make 46 saves. Rangers beat the Devils at the Garden 6-3. Huge night for Tony DeAngelo, had the hat trick plus two assists. College hoops, Hofstra won on a shot at the buzzer. Northeast Conference play, a win for LIU. Losses for Wagner and St. Francis. With the Bloomberg NBC Sports Update, I'm John Stashower. Nathan?
All right, John, thank you. It's 5:37 on Wall Street, and the latest edition of Bloomberg Business Week is on newsstands now with the cover on the hidden dangers of the ETF takeover. Annie Massa wrote the story for Bloomberg Business Week.
The index fund firms like BlackRock, Vanguard, and State Street have the voting rights for all the companies that are underlying those index products. As a result, they've amassed a ton of voting power in each of these companies that they own.
And you can read more about this and other stories in this week's edition of Bloomberg Business Week on newsstands now and online at businessweek.com. Terminal customers can receive a complimentary subscription at MAG Go and listen to Business Week with Carol Masser and Jason Kelly weekdays at 2 p.m. Wall Street time here on Bloomberg Radio. It's 5:38 on Wall Street. Now it's time for the Tri-State Business Report. Happy Friday, Bloomberg's Ed Corey.
Hey, same to you, Nathan. A plan to double New York's beer tax is being proposed as a way to fund the State University of New York system and its New York City counterpart. It gained some ground this week as a Manhattan Assembly member who proposed the increase was joined by a Senate sponsor. Well, several states that allow betting on the NFL have authorized wagering on the upstart XFL Football League. Regulators in New Jersey aren't saying if they're considering it, but the AP reports several sportsbooks say they have asked New Jersey for permission to offer XFL betting. Groton, Connecticut will consider an ordinance next month to reduce single-use plastics and polystyrene. The plan would ban businesses and food service establishments from providing items like plastic carry-out bags and polystyrene food service products. It would also ban places from providing plastic straws unless somebody asks for one. That's your Bloomberg Tri-State Business Report. I'm Ed Corey. Nathan?
Thanks, Ed. 5:39 on Wall Street. Bloomberg Radio is on the air from San Francisco to New York, London to Hong Kong. Let's check in with our global news team for some of the top stories heard on our 300 affiliate radio stations around the world.
I'm Jeff Bellinger, and on Cogo in San Diego, I'm reporting the trucking industry won a court victory in California.
I'm Courtney Donahoe on KTRH in Houston. Oil is heading for its first weekly loss since November as war risk fades.
I'm Caroline Hepcom, Bloomberg DAB, digital radio in London. We're reporting on Ryanair, Europe's biggest low-cost airline. It's Christmas and New Year travel booking boom.
I'm Gina Cervetti, and on WBBM in Chicago, I'm reporting that Grubhub says the food delivery company is not for sale, pushing back against media reports that sent the shares surging.
I'm Ed Corey on KFBK in Sacramento. I'm reporting Apple has been sued by Massimo for allegedly stealing trade secrets.
And those are some of the stories our 2,700 Bloomberg journalists and analysts are working on this morning around the world. Another story we're watching this morning, KB Home's focus on first-time buyers is paying off. The Los Angeles home builder reported quarterly orders that beat estimates. Purchase contracts soared 38% from a year earlier as lower mortgage rates boosted demand for KB Home's affordable properties. Futures pointing to a higher open this morning on this Jobs Friday. The December payrolls report due out at 8:30 a.m. Wall Street time. Right now, S&P futures are up 8 points. Dow futures up 65. NASDAQ futures a gain of 32. This is Bloomberg.
Rich is just a really, really, really good guy. The term good egg isn't enough to describe him. He's also certified organic and free range. Rich puts the cap back on everything. The toothpaste, the olive oil, the shampoo, everything. He lets his 10-year-old nephew beat him at virtual tennis, even though he can straight up slay his 10-year-old nephew in virtual tennis. When the toilet paper is running low, Rich replaces the roll on the actual holder, not just on the back of the toilet. Rich is texting and driving. Rich? No. What are you doing, Rich? everyone how great you are. Texting and driving makes good people look bad. Visit StopTextStopWrecks.org, a public service announcement brought to you by the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration and the Ad Council.
Asset managers who seize change to launch new strategies, add distribution channels, or exploit new technology to re-engineer the investor experience are often rewarded. However, in an industry paralyzed with complexity, few act with agility or decisively. Few run their business strategically. Yet, the most competitive managers in the market know, with the right partner and a flexible operating platform, you can. Go boldly toward change with SEI Investment Manager Services.
I'm Steve Meyer, president of SEI's Investment Manager Services. At SEI, we understand the emerging forces that will define success for asset managers and what firms will need to compete tomorrow. That's why we continually optimize SEI's global operating platform. If your business requires greater agility, our advanced technology, integrated best-in-class systems, and multi-asset expertise can be your catalyst for business transformation.
With SEI Investment Manager Services, you lead the charge in a competitive marketplace. Learn more at seic.com/seize change.
The Honda Jazz, the car that feels fabulously small on the outside, yet deceptively big on the inside, with its incredible storage solutions and magic folding seats, not to mention the suite of advanced safety features. And now with the small but big Jazz event, it's available with 0% APR representative and 5 years complimentary servicing until January 31st. Visit your local dealer to find out more. Honda dealers are credit brokers, not lenders. Finance provided by Honda Finance Europe, authorized and regulated by the Financial Conduct Authority. Terms and conditions apply.
I've always loved a kitchen experiment, especially smoothies. I've blended all sorts of mad combinations. Strawberry and charcoal, broccoli and chocolate. Not my best, that. But when I test blenders in the Witch Lab, it's not about flavour, it's about performance. Our tests use proper tough stuff, hard ice, strong veg, rough nuts. And the blenders that can hack it are the only ones we recommend for your kitchen.
Which tests harder so you can buy smarter? Visit which.co.uk.
Imagine yourself in an unspoiled paradise, discovering the charms of a new city, or sampling street food with the locals. Fly from London to more than 160 destinations worldwide and make 2020 a year like never before with Qatar Airways. Named world's best airline by Skytrax. Our incredible selection of special fares are available now. Book today at QatarAirways.com. Qatar Airways. Going places. Together.
On a TUI tour, our English-speaking local guides will take you off the tourist trail. They won't just help you find the perfect souvenir, they'll show you how to make it. Choose from over 70 unforgettable tours worldwide. From tranquil temples in India to sunrise safaris in South Africa, on a TUI tour, we cross the T's, dot the I's, and put you in the middle. Book now and enjoy up to £200 off per booking. Booking T's and C's and minimum spend applies. Selected holidays only. At all protected.
This week on the New Yorker Radio Hour, has Silicon Valley changed since all the revelations about the world's social media companies?
I think people are really reluctant to relinquish this narrative of being underdogs, of being leaders, of just trying to experiment and make the world better.
Listen to this episode of the New Yorker Radio Hour on TuneIn today.
A day on air and at TikTok on Twitter, powered by more than 2,700 journalists and analysts in over 120 countries. This is Bloomberg Radio. Now, a global news update.
U.S., Canadian, and British leaders say it is highly likely that an Iranian anti-aircraft missile downed that civilian Ukrainian jetliner, killing all 176 people aboard. Meantime, the House passes a resolution that seeks to rein in further escalation of military actions. Correspondent Linda Kenyon.
House Republican leader Kevin McCarthy argued the resolution was all about partisan politics, meant only to undermine national security and unity.
Now is the time for our country to come together and speak with one voice. Not as Republicans, not as Democrats, but as Americans. But instead of working with this administration to continue work towards shared goals, Democrats are using this moment to continue their hatred towards the president.
The Senate is poised to take up a similar resolution perhaps as soon as next week.
House Speaker Nancy Pelosi says she will probably soon transmit the articles of impeachment against President Trump to the Senate. I'm John Trout.
Why all the top-tier experts? Because business is not a magic trick.
Give us a sense of the economic backdrop.
Bloomberg Markets.
Which financial records are these?
Weekday mornings at 10 Eastern on Bloomberg Radio. Bloomberg, the world is listening. Markets, headlines, and breaking news 24 hours a day at Bloomberg.com, the Bloomberg Business app, and on Quick Take by Bloomberg. This is a Bloomberg Business Flash.
And I'm Karen Moscow. U.S. stock index futures are edging higher before a key U.S. jobs report and treasuries are drifting. We check the markets every 15 minutes throughout the trading day on Bloomberg. S&P futures up about 8 points. Dow futures up 63. NASDAQ futures up 32. The DAX in Germany's up 0.25%. 10-year treasury, little change. Yield 1.85%. Yield on the 2-year, 1.58%. NYMEX crude oil is down 0.2% to 13 cents at $59.43 a barrel. COMEX gold is down 0.3% or $4.80 at $15.49.50 an ounce. The euro, 1.1093 against the dollar. British pound, 1.3060. And the yen is at 109.62. The December jobs report is at 8:30 Wall Street time, then at 10 wholesale inventories. And that's a Bloomberg Business Flash. Now here's Michael Barr with more on what's going on around the world. Michael.
Karen, Iran is denying a missile hit a Ukrainian airplane that crashed near Tehran this week and is calling on the U.S. and Canada to release data backing their allegations. Western leaders say the plane appeared to have been unintentionally hit by an Iranian missile just hours after Iran launched a series of ballistic missiles on two American bases in Iraq. Meanwhile, Iran has invited the NTSB to take part in the probe of the crash. The House passed a resolution that aims to limit the powers that President Trump has to take on certain military actions against Iran. According to the measure, those actions would need to be approved by Congress. In the NHL, the Rangers beat the Devils 6-3. The Bruins won. In the NBA, the Celtics lost. Global news 24 hours a day, on air, and on Quick Take by Bloomberg. Powered by more than 2,700 journalists and analysts in more than 120 countries. I'm Michael Barr. This is Bloomberg, Nathan.
Okay, Mike. Thank you. It's just before 5:49 on Wall Street, live from the Bloomberg Interactive Brokers Studios. This is Bloomberg Daybreak. We want to get more now on the passenger jet crash in Iran on Wednesday. Bloomberg senior reporter for international affairs, Mark Champion, joins us this morning. Mark, as we heard from Michael, Iran is denying that a missile hit this Boeing Ukrainian jet. Tell us more about what Iran is saying and what we're hearing from Western governments who say that their intelligence indicates that this may have been an unintentional missile strike.
Yes. So the Iranians are saying that they're definitively saying it was not a missile strike. They're also saying that claims from Canada, Australia, and the UK that it was a mistaken missile strike by the Iranians on the aircraft is psychological warfare. So what the Canadians are basing their claim on is apparently U.S. Satellite data, which showed missile launches, two missile launches, 2 minutes after the plane took off. And thereafter, the plane catching fire. So we don't know for sure. These are intelligence reports. We don't know for sure, you know, what happened. But clearly, this is a highly political issue. The Iranians are being open to the normal kind of international investigation, with the exception that they're saying they want to download the black boxes themselves, and they maintain the investigation will take 1 to 2 years.
Wow. Now, we did hear as well that Iran is saying that it's open to international involvement in this investigation. But obviously, with the geopolitical tensions we've seen between the U.S. and Iran over the last week, that's going to be a very complicated process, isn't it?
It will be, but it isn't just the U.S. You know, the U.S. Would normally have the right to take part because it manufactured the plane. So the NTSB would normally be involved. The NTSB itself may have difficulty getting people into Iran because of sanctions, because of safety concerns and so on. They may be able to appoint someone else. You know, we'll see how that develops. But there are other options. You know, the French, there are various countries that have very well-respected investigative bodies for air crashes, not just the U.S. So there are others. France is at the top of the list. They've been involved before in this kind of thing. You know, so there will be several countries involved.
Now, if there is indication that a surface-to-air missile was involved in the downing of this plane, I mean, that would leave some pretty telltale signs compared to other types of weapons, wouldn't they?
Yes, it would. So when a missile strikes a plane, then it leaves shrapnel marks, holes in the fuselage. Unfortunately, it would leave also pieces of shrapnel in some of the passengers. Within the plane, you'd see it. So once they're on the ground and they can trawl through, it's not, social media pictures won't help a great deal. It's very difficult to pick this stuff out at that level because the plane is already in fragments. But once the inspectors are on the ground, they should fairly quickly be able to determine whether a missile is likely to have struck the plane.
Now, if a missile is found to have struck this plane, what kind of liability could Iran or even the Ukrainian airline be opening itself up to?
I think it would be too early to say because a lot of things would have to be established first. So I think, that would come quite far down the line. You know, it does take a while for the final investigation to be completed. And that would be, sometime in the future, perhaps a year or more. And at that point, it would depend on what the findings were.
And in our last 30 seconds here, I mean, what kind of information could we expect to get from the black boxes were this to be some kind of missile strike?
Well, the black box is a key. So, in previous missile strikes, for example, once the black boxes were downloaded, there are sound recordings in there, amongst other things. At the moment of strike, there's a sound wave just before, everything is blown up. So that the black box itself stops recording. But still, for that split second, a sound wave is heard, for example, and that can be a sort of defining element. It can even tell you what part of the plane was hit.
All right. Bloomberg Senior Reporter for International Affairs, Mark Champion, thank you for this. Much appreciated. Karen?
Nathan, thank you. It is 5:54 on Wall Street. It's time for the Bloomberg Law Report. Let's get to the legal stories we're watching this morning from Bloomberg's Jeff Bellinger.
California Governor Gavin Newsom's proposed budget calls for spending $2 billion for wildfires and other emergencies. Hundreds of new firefighters would be hired and infrastructure would be hardened. A federal court ruled a Louisiana hospital does not have to pay statutory damages or legal fees for infringing a company's copyright. And Lyft is offering to pay its New York drivers between $100 and $600 each to settle a lawsuit alleging the company misclassified them as contractors instead of employees.
Bloomberg Law. Everything you need on one legal research platform. Guidance, analysis, and Bloomberg Market Intelligence. Find out more at BloombergLaw.com.
And now another legal development we're watching. The U.S. House of Representatives voting to limit President Trump's authority to strike Iran. It's mostly symbolic move that Democrats say defends the constitutional power of Congress. Republicans say it endangers national security. For more on the move, Bloomberg's June Grasso speaks with Ona Hathaway, professor of international law at Yale and a former national security lawyer for the Defense Department.
In the past, presidents of both parties have argued that it's an unconstitutional infringement of their authority, and the White House issued a statement challenging the resolution, saying it's unnecessary and would lack the force of law. The statement of administration policy said the military actions it would apply to are already authorized under a 2002 authorization for use of military force for Iraq.
That is a pretty absurd claim. So the 2002 authorization for use of military force was passed by the U.S. government when Saddam Hussein was in power. And Congress gave President Bush the power to launch a war against Iraq to rid the country of the government of Saddam Hussein, who we believed had weapons of mass destruction, or at least who the administration claimed had weapons of mass destruction, that posed a direct threat to Americans and to allies in the region. Now they're claiming 18 years later that somehow that resolution that was passed for that very particular purpose can be used to justify an attack on an Iranian general who just happened to be visiting Iraq. That just is passing absurd.
Even if both the House and Senate passed the resolution with enough votes to override a presidential veto, wouldn't Trump claim a constitutional right to defy the resolution? And what happens then?
He may very well claim a right to defy the resolution. He has shown that he doesn't have a whole lot of regard for the resolution or indeed for the U.S. Constitution. And then Congress is really going to be in a difficult situation, so it doesn't have a whole lot of options. Congress could override a veto of a resolution that seeks to prevent the president from acting. And if it succeeded in that, then I do think that that would be effective. But the chances are highly unlikely that it would override a veto. It requires a two-thirds vote in both the House and the Senate. And remember, of course, the Senate is controlled by Republicans. And so that would be unlikely to actually succeed in going through.
And that's Yale International Law Professor Ona Hathaway speaking with Bloomberg's June Grasso. Catch more of that interview plus analysis of the latest legal news by subscribing to the Bloomberg Law Podcast or downloading the show at Bloomberg.com/podcasts. And attorneys can find exceptional legal research and business development tools at BloombergLaw.com. S&P futures up 7 points this morning and Bloomberg Daybreak continues.
That pleasant breeze when you first step off the plane. The first warm welcome from a friendly local. And that first sip of something chilled by the sun-drenched shore. Your first trip to the Algarve is rarely your last. At Sunhat Villas, we've been Algarve specialists for over 19 years. Browse our portfolio of fabulous villas and find the perfect place to stay during your next Algarve escape. Search Sunhat Villas. Ads are protected.
Martin here loves being his own boss, but staying on top of all the tax rules used to drive him up the stud wall. This 31st of January self-assessment deadline, however, Martin won't be hitting the roof. Just a few buttons. He's using QuickBooks Self-Employed to make sure his tax bill is all above board. It tracks income and expenses, so he always knows what he owes. You could say he smashed it.
Visit quickbooks.co.uk for details. Intuit QuickBooks.
Imagine yourself in an unspoiled paradise, discovering the charms of a new city, or sampling street food with the locals. Fly from London to more than 160 destinations worldwide and make 2020 a year like never before with Qatar Airways. Named world's best airline by Skytrax, our incredible selection of special fares are available now. Book today at QatarAirways.com. Qatar Airways, going places together.
Capital of the world, 24 hours a day at Bloomberg.com, on the Bloomberg Business app, and on Quick Take by Bloomberg. This is Bloomberg Radio.
Live from the Bloomberg Interactive Broker Studios, this is Bloomberg Daybreak for Friday, January 10th, 2020. Coming up this hour.
Fresh intelligence suggests the plane that crashed in Iran was brought down by a missile.
Boeing gains on the news, but immediately comes under fire on additional fronts.
Up next, the focus turns to jobs as Wall Street awaits December's U.S. payrolls report.
The House votes to curb President Trump's power to strike Iran. Plus, Joe Biden picks up a big endorsement for president. I'm Michael Barr. More ahead.
I'm John Stashower in sports. Joe Judge was by all accounts impressive as the Giants introduced their new coach. Hockey at the Garden, the Rangers beat the Devils.
That's all straight ahead on Bloomberg Daybreak. On Bloomberg 1130 New York, Bloomberg 99.1 Washington, D.C., Bloomberg 1061 Boston, Bloomberg 960 San Francisco, Sirius XM 119, and around the world on BloombergRadio.com and via the Bloomberg Business app.
Good morning. I'm Karen Moscow.
I'm Nathan Hager. Bloomberg Daybreak brought to you by Portfolio Analyst, powered by Interactive Brokers. Savvy investors use Portfolio Analyst to create a consolidated view of their finances and check the health of their complete financial portfolio. Sign up for free at PortfolioAnalyst.com.
And global stocks in a bit of a holding pattern ahead of today's U.S. jobs report, 6:01 on Wall Street, and we check the markets every 15 minutes throughout the trading day on Bloomberg. Futures are higher, with S&P futures up 7 points, Dow futures up 54, NASDAQ futures up 32, the DAX in Germany is up 0.2%, and the CAC in Paris and the FTSE 100 are little changed. Nikkei 225 in Japan jumped 0.5%, and the Hang Seng in Hong Kong was up 0.25%. 10-year Treasury, little change, yield 1.85%, yield on the 2-year 1.58%. NYMEX crude oil is down 0.2% or 10 cents at $59.46 a barrel. COMEX gold is down 0.3% or $4.70 at $15.49.60 an ounce. The euro at 1.1087 against the dollar, and the yen 109.62. Nathan.
Karen, we begin with fresh details on the passenger jet that crashed in Iran on Wednesday. Intelligence suggests the plane was likely brought down by a missile, according to Canadian Prime Minister Justin Trudeau.
The evidence indicates that the plane was shot down by an Iranian surface-to-air missile. This may well have been unintentional.
Australia and the UK also think an Iranian missile brought down the jet. U.S. President Donald Trump says he's suspicious of the circumstances.
It was flying in a pretty rough neighborhood, and somebody could have made a mistake. Some people say it was mechanical. I personally don't think that's even a question, personally.
Iran's government denies allegations a missile brought down the plane.
But Bloomberg News has learned a U.S. spy satellite detected two missile launches from an Iranian battery just minutes after the jet took off. Here with more is Bloomberg National Security reporter Bill Ferries.
The thinking so far is that it would be a surface-to-air missile, Iranian defense mechanisms that would have been turned on in case the U.S. somehow launched a response to the Iranian attack on the airbase in Iraq. So this would have been